Today, for the 157,000th time, we are going to listen to Metallica's self-titled, otherwise known as The Black Album. Hello, everybody, and welcome back to another album reaction. And I am so excited for what we have today. The most important and special thing that we have today is that for the very first time, I have a second guest on the channel. Hello, Chris.
Hello.
Hello, Chris.
Hello, Chris.
Yeah. So right away, let's get that out of the way right away. Your name's Chris. His name is Chris. This is going to be confusing if I'm trying to talk to anybody and I don't know, you know.
We'll Patrick have to only knows happens. People named Chris.
Everybody in my life is named Chris. It's a miracle.
Is it?
Actually, it's awful. Yeah, it's terrible. So hello, everybody, and welcome. I'm so excited that we're doing this. We did not know for sure that we were going to be doing this video, but we had some comments on the And Justice for All video, and there have been comments actually on the Master of Puppets and the Ride, the Lightning video as well, wanting us to react to the Black Album. And so first thing I have to say is that, yes, I have heard this Metallica album. This is the one Metallica album that I had heard before we started doing these reactions here on my channel. Both of the Chrises have also heard this album many times, though I think for you specifically, Chris Schoenberg, it's been a long time probably since you've listened to this album.
This might be the first time that I've ever listened to it the whole way through. And it might also be the first time I've ever listened to it the whole way through on headphones, almost surely.
Okay, that's awesome, because I'm really excited. I'm really excited to talk about the mix. Mm-hmm. Chris Parker, when's the last time you listened to this album?
Very recently. It comes up a lot.
Okay, that's awesome. That's cool. I personally have not listened to this album since I purchased the remastered version that I believe came out in 2021. So this is a very recent, this is just 2 years ago. I bought this CD at Walmart for $5. You can go to any Walmart in the entire universe and buy this CD for $5. They got millions of these things just floating around. So now I do have, and I've said this in other videos as well, I do have an original copy of the original album from 1991. And this is one of the first albums that I ever purchased, one of the first CDs that I ever bought. And the reason for that is because it was the Sandman's entrance theme in WCW. But we've talked a little bit about that in the Ride the Lightning video. Before we get too far...
Ride the Lightning was the first Metallica album I ever bought. And no, it was one of the first albums I ever bought. But
sure.
Metallica, the first Metallica album I ever knew about was Reload. My dad had it.
Was it on CD or was it on cassette?
It was on CD,
on
yeah.
CD? Mm.
That was well into the CD era. I mean, that was...
Yeah, Reload was Reload? 98.
Not okay.
Oh, I know that. But I'm just like, I remember being when I was in like probably junior high, and I remember going to the store with my friend and him having to make the decision: did he want to spend $8.99 for the Rob Zombie Hellbilly Deluxe cassette, or $10.99 for the Rob Zombie Hellbilly Deluxe CD?
Right.
He bought the cassette because he was cheap. You know.
Technically, the very
now,
first
that
album...
cassette would be worth way more than the CD. I'll tell you that.
Wow. Well, I think one of the very first albums I ever owned at all. Was one of the Ted Nugent albums. I found it in the grass in front of my grandma's house.
Dude,
I
yes.
picked it up and took it home.
Dude, yes. Found albums are like the best thing. I've got like probably four or five of them that I just found in parking lots and stuff. For sure.
Cassettes take to being found in parking lots a lot better than CDs do.
Yeah,
sure.
Well, and people just, they don't care, you know, honestly.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's funny. Before we get too far into the video, though, I just want to say for everybody watching, if this is your first time here, welcome. What we're going to do is talk a little bit about Metallica. And since this is Chris Parker's first video on my channel where we're talking about Metallica with him, I want him to go through and talk about how he feels about Metallica and his sort of history with enjoying the band or not liking the band. And so we'll talk about that stuff a little bit at the beginning, talk about the Black Album a bit. Then we'll actually listen to the entire album. And I think what we're going to have to do, because of the way we have everything set up with Chris being here, is we're going to listen to a song and then we can maybe talk about it a little bit while it's playing, but we'll do probably a majority of the talking in between tracks. We can go through and kind of discuss everything, talk about the mix, whatever we want to talk about. So then afterwards, we might talk about the whole album a little bit, but we'll just kind of see how long we talk between songs and how long this video ends up being. Mm-hmm. But before we get to those things, I just want to say that I will try to include the audio from this album in the video that you're watching now. So hopefully you'll be able to hear everything that we're hearing exactly how we're hearing it. But this album is by far Metallica's biggest album. And if there is any album they have where the songs would be copyrighted in such a way that they don't want people to just willy-nilly use them on YouTube, it would absolutely be this album. However, and looking at the back here, this is on being released on Blackened Records.
That's probably a big reason why they remastered it.
I assume that it's Metallica's own record label, correct?
It is, yeah.
And so far on my channel, I've been able to use the audio from Ride the Lightning, Master of Puppets, and Justice for All totally fine in the video. So I'm going to assume that we'll be able to use the audio from the Black album. However, if for whatever reason I can't include the audio, no, I'll still upload the video exactly the way we record it, and I'll clearly have everything labeled on screen so that hopefully you can get your own copy, whether it's on Spotify or whatever. I'll include links in the description to download the album or to, you know, just listen to the album however you want to. You can sync up with us if you have to, so you can listen along with us. But hopefully it doesn't come to that. Cross your fingers and toes.
And we would like to thank the fine people at YouTube and Metallica for understanding the fair use clause of copyright law.
That's true. Yeah. I don't know if the YouTube algorithm itself understands that, but we're getting pretty close to sentient algorithms, so it might actually be under...
Thank you, Chris and Patrick, for understanding and finally giving me the credit that I deserve.
In 10 years, I would like to thank our robot overlords.
Yes. And one other thing I want to mention is that I will have timestamps. If you'll notice on the timeline of this video, there will be timestamps included in the description to all the different individual songs and the different sections, and I try to do that because I know not everyone wants to sit and listen to us talk about Metallica for 3 hours. However, if you're a real true Metallica fan, you obviously would do that. And only true Metallica fans listen to our channel and our reactions, right? But if you want to skip around, no hard feelings on our end. Skip around, watch whatever you want. Feel free to leave a comment, like, subscribe, whatever. All of this is leading up to the release of 72 Seasons on April 14th. We'll be recording our reaction to that, hopefully with Chris as well. So both Chris's and I will be doing a reaction to 72 Seasons. And we'll probably be doing that, I would assume, if we can, the week after that comes out.
We're not doing it at midnight? Like, when it comes out, we're not going to sit here and refresh Spotify until it, like, comes out?
No. I would do that, but no, I don't think we're going to do that.
Okay.
And it'll probably be leaked early, like the Depeche Mode album that comes out this Friday that was leaked earlier today that I'm not going to listen to until it comes out officially on Friday.
Comment below. Do you think the new Metallica record will be leaked? We want to know what you think.
Oh, I'm sure it will.
One thing I find interesting about releases is a lot of times, being on the West Coast, 9 p.m. is when stuff shows up because it's midnight East Coast.
That's true.
And I don't know if everything follows that rule, but I see it a lot.
Not everything does, but certain things do. The thing that always boggles my mind is that in the Midwest, WWE always airs live. So like Monday Night Raw is live no matter where they're at in the United States. But if it's airing here at 7 p.m., it airs at 7 p.m. on the West Coast as well. So it's 2 hours late there, right? You're 1 hour or 2 hours?
Two.
2 hours. So it actually airs 2 hours later there, and that's... That blows my mind. Are sporting events like that and stuff too? It couldn't be. Well, I mean, WWE is a sport.
It is.
It's sport entertainment.
WWE is theater, sir.
It's dramatized sports
entertainment. This is not a wrestling video.
We could make it wrestling.
And thank God, because I've run out of things to say about it already.
Hey, they have a huge connection to Metallica because they use that awesome Kid Rock song in a lot of Undertaker things, right?
Yes.
The best Metallica song that we're going to listen to today.
American Badass?
That Kid Rock song.
That Kid Rock song.
I've got an incredible story about that when we get to it.
We'll get to it. Okay, so Chris, do you want to just take the floor for a little bit and talk about your feelings about Metallica? We've had 3 videos to talk about. We've had a combined, I think, like 9 hours already to talk about Metallica. So you can. Well, how do you feel about them?
Unless something changes, I still consider Metallica to be ultimately my favorite band of all time. And it's not, you know, it's not something I just like walk around covered in Metallica stuff all the time, but it's just every single time I go back to it, it's like, oh yeah, here's the thing that is the reason I love all of the stuff that I like. Because there's just like a certain age where you start making your own decisions about the things that you like, and it's like 12, 13.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, we're talking 98, 99. That's right. You know, that's when Reload happened. My dad bought the album because he was a big Black Album fan. And then it wasn't even until about 2000, I sub- suppose, when I got into them big time, right when Newstead left. And I started on Reload and I loved it. And then I had a friend who was like, that's not Metallica. And he gave me Injustice for All. And he's like, listen to this. This is real f-ing music. Mm. And I was like, oh, okay. And I started and I was like, no. And then I was like, well, yeah, it's pretty good, you know. And then it just, you know, it all went from there. But as far, like, I also consider myself to be one of the only people who really likes at least something about all Metallica albums.
Mm.
Like, I know there's a lot of people who are like, everything after Black is garbage, and I don't have any real reason to stand around and tell them they're wrong about that. But I also, there's a lot of people who are like, everything after Justice is garbage. It's like, yeah, you're kind of shit. But I don't know. I'm such a huge fan of theirs. Load and Reload and all of the stuff after Black is so interesting. And I often say that, like, the biggest problem with all of their post-Black music is that it's Metallica. Because if it was a different band, it would be like, okay, great. But they built up to such a white hot peak at, like, leading up to the Black album. And then at that album where it's like, okay, well, now what? We change. And oh no. But there's a lot of merit in that. I think there's a lot of bluesy stuff in that later stuff. It's just, you know, five albums of some of the most genre changing music of all time. It's like, I'm not going to say that people don't deserve to be frustrated that this one of the greatest bands of all time suddenly decided to make music that is actively not for all of the people that were part of making them that way in the first place.
Right.
But otherwise, I have many things to say. And I was going to write a very long, very complainy comment on your Ride the Lightning video. I had it on, and I was like, here we go. And then I got distracted by something. And then later I was like, yeah, whatever. F- it. But
what was the nature of your complainy comment?
What were you going to say?
I didn't like his attitude most of the time. Now, like, you listen here, like,
but you know, so having have you watched the entirety of all three of our videos that we released?
No, I watched some of Lightning, none of Puppets, and I did just watch all of Justice because Justice is my favorite album.
Okay, that's what one thing I was going to ask was what your favorite Metallica album is. It is Justice.
Yep,
okay.
It is.
Mm-hmm. Now, you will probably know, because you and I have been friends for a long time, just like I've been friends with this Chris as well. But I don't know if you guys have ever really had opportunity to talk before, have you?
I don't think so.
Not really. Once or twice. But
yeah, I was going to say, I thought maybe a couple times you were maybe together at the studio. Once or twice.
That would make sense.
Maybe.
That's true. Because
Chris is also a big friend of Graham's and of Austin's, my old roommate Austin's.
Yeah, for sure.
So that's kind of how we all were in the same circles. But Chris, you and I have talked a lot about music production stuff as well as us talking about music production stuff. And so you can probably guess where I was coming from with the Ride the Lightning specifically, but also the other two albums as well. Like, because I have no nostalgia for those albums, it is really hard for me to get over the fact that objectionably, like, Ride the Lightning does not sound good. Like, it doesn't sound good.
No.
I'd give anything for all those albums to be, like, re-recorded in
would
modern times.
Know?
I would.
It would be interesting, and there's people that have done it, but, like,
yeah.
You were talking about Patrick's attitude.
You weren't talking about Chris's attitude, right?
Right, yeah.
I mean, right, because I'm going to do this again. I think I've done this in every video since the first one, but I actually really do like Metallica, and they have been, I would not say that they're my favorite band, but I really do, and they've been a huge influence on me. And doing this thing, it has changed my, I'm taking Chris's time, but sorry.
That's all right. No, it doesn't matter.
I like Kirk Hammett more than I did before.
Okay.
I would have been more likely to make cracks about him, and I don't think that I will be doing that as much. Although I will say, every time that you play fast pentatonic stuff over a metal song, that you just call that Kirk Hammett. Just like you call triplets on the bell of a ride cymbal Chris Adler.
Okay.
But anyway, that, and, like, I did not realize how much those records, specifically Master of Puppets and Ride the Lightning, were such a huge influence on me. And I mean, because it was just like, right, I'm sure it was a way for you too, Chris. It was just like the air that you breathe. Like, it's just around, and you don't even hardly think about it. Like,
That's why it's fun to like do these like close listens to stuff. Even it, like what we're going to do today, like all of us have heard this album, but I'll bet we're going to be blown away by some stuff.
And this might be the this is one of the Metallica records that I've heard the least.
Yeah, all the way through. Right. And so I think you guys are going to be shocked. Have you heard the remastered version, Chris?
I have, but it's been a little while.
This specific remastered version, I don't know the difference between any of the other remasters, but
I have honestly really struggled to ever hear the difference in any remastered album flat out.
Okay. All right. Well, that's interesting.
Which it bothers me a lot because I'm a sound designer, but right. I just don't hear it. It's so difficult.
Well, we'll see, because I think one thing we're going to be shocked about, and I've said this before in all of our other videos, the last time I listened to this, all I could think about was, that is the most massive sounding kick drum I've ever heard in my entire life.
The drums in general
are the most
size of towns.
The thing we're going to hear the most is the kick drum. It is going to be kick drum, kick drum, kick drum, the entire song. Now, I'm really curious to see if, I'm thinking of Enter Sandman and, like, Nothing Else Matters when I say that. I will be very curious if we get to the faster songs, because I know there are some faster songs on the album. The kick surely can't sound that same way. This just giant, massive, like, very modern-sounding kick drum. So I'm really curious to see what we all think of it in terms of the mix, especially because we've done the three previous videos building up to this. And I would say so far, every one of Metallica's albums has sounded better to me.
Oh, yeah.
And I would even say that with And Justice for All, because I really did like the way And Justice for All sounded. I think that there definitely was like a bit of a bass issue, and I think that they made up for that by having a lot more low end from the guitars in the mix, which made the mix very interesting. And I will say to the people watching the video, when I was editing the And Justice for All video, I was using my earbuds, and I thought the album sounded really bad. There was no low end in it whatsoever. And I'm not just saying there was no bass. I'm saying there was no low end coming from anything, because I was just listening in my headphones and my earbuds. And in doing that, it really showed the imperfections of the mix. It showed like the negative sides to the mix. Now, that's true for anything. Anytime you listen to music without any low end, especially music that's heavy music that's supposed to be crunchy and big and thick, a lot of that crunchy, big thickness comes from the guitars and the low end. And so listening to an album like And Justice for All with no low end, it was like almost unbearable. I actually had to go and get these headphones and continue editing on these headphones, because I knew it sounded good on these headphones because this is what I listened to it on. So that was a really interesting thing for me, but I still would say that I think I like the And Justice for All mix more than Master of Puppets. I do think that Master of Puppets I think maybe Master of Puppets is a bit more of like it's certainly a more consistent mix with what would be expected of it. Like, And Justice for All is kind of like an anomaly. The fact that it does sound as good as it does, knowing that there isn't as much bass in there. But, you know,
I think the real standout for Justice is the drums.
Oh, I would say the guitars, 1,000%. Yeah. I think the drums did not even sound good to me. And Chris and I even mentioned that in the video. Like, we were talking about how, and I was thinking about it a lot afterwards as well, and I don't know if we outright said this, but it was something I was thinking. Like, if you took any one of the individual sounds that we were hearing on And Justice for All, whether it was just the hi-hat or the kick or the snare or the one guitar track or the other guitar track or the bass, and you just listened to them by themselves, it probably would have sounded not good.
Well, but that's the case with anything.
Yes, to an extent. But I do think that with this, it was way more pronounced. Like, the idea that it all sounded so good when it was together was definitely true. But I think if you would have separated those things, like especially the snare drum, I think sounds so odd. But it just worked in context of the mix, I think. The dryness of the mix and the more like the more like overall dry nature of the mix, which I'm really curious. Well, we'll get to this when we get to the album, but I'm so curious to see what happens when we get to the reverb. What am I going to think of the reverb on this? Because I bet there's going to be a lot more reverb than I remember there being. And I'm curious to see if James' vocals will have more effects on them than they did on Justice. Because on Justice, there wasn't very many effects. They did effects in songs. That was the other thing we were really shocked about, was like the amount of like audio tricks and effects and things that were done. And so we know there's going to be a lot of that stuff here. But
do
not,
we?
I'm assuming.
I mean, this is so much different than the other videos that we've done, because now we're like building up audio expectations. And I, well, but you've heard this record. I was trying very hard not to do that.
Oh, okay.
And yeah, but like, I don't, I mean, it's your party.
Well, no, I just, I don't know. I'm just curious to see what's going to happen. But like, I do think that this is going to be the best sounding Metallica album. I think
that's true. With the, I have a lot of, oh, and well, it's interesting because this is the, you know, they did their first producer change for this.
Mm-hmm.
For Lightning up through Justice, they had a guy named Fleming Rasmussen.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and then this was Bob Rock. And then everything after Black all the way up through to the end of Saint Anger was Bob Rock. And I think, I don't know, I feel like Metallica, being one of the biggest bands of all time, has oddly struggled a lot with sounding really good.
But their, yeah, their, I don't think they've ever
sounded good.
I definitely don't think that I've ever heard a Metallica song that sounded as good as it should have.
No, and I think that that's what, and I mentioned this in a previous video, but like audio quality wise and musical quality wise, like I stand by that. That is one of the reasons that I like Metallica so much, is that every once in a while they just drop a fat turd.
Mm-hmm.
And like, it makes it interesting because you don't know, like that's sort of the mystique about
Metallica,
about 72 seasons that's coming, because you're like, what if the whole thing is just programmed kick drum? Like, you don't know, they could totally do it. What if they, like, they bring up the ghosted Lou Reed and like redo the table song? Like, who right, knows right. what's gonna happen? Like,
that's a funny take. I like that.
I do. I will say again though that I did really like the way that Lux Eterna sounded. The sound, like the sonic. That's the name of the song, right? Lux Eterna.
Yeah.
Eterna.
Have you listened to Hardwired at all? The 2016 album.
No, I've heard no Metallica past this album.
I really love that album a lot. It's one of my favorites. That
really?
2016 album, yeah.
Was that was the one you liked as well, right? Or did you like Death Magnetic more?
I like the songs on Death Magnetic a lot, and I liked the Lady Gaga song on Hardwired a lot. I really do.
Mm-hmm.
They did
a song with Lady Gaga?
Well, not on the record, but they did it at the Grammys, and then it failed.
Oh,
and like,
okay,
but
sure.
Somebody
refixed it. Oh, interesting. I didn't know that.
Yeah, it was cool. The Moth Into the Flame one, and I guess like. Yeah, anyway.
That's cool. That's
and
awesome.
Like, and then they joked about it, like, maybe we'll do more stuff with Lady Gaga. Maybe we'll get
Dude,
a Lady
maybe
Gaga.
There'll be a Lady Gaga cast.
Boy, wouldn't that be
awesome.
That
would be awesome.
That would
like,
be awesome.
People will lose their minds.
I would be so here for that if they did that, because that is the boldest goddamn move.
That, right? Like,
for sure.
I would be
sure.
fascinated, actually, to hear how you feel about Death Magnetic, Patrick, because of the whole, like, they had that whole big controversy about how Death Magnetic is just a big audio sausage brick. Like, if you open it up in the mix, it's just like, and so it ended up being that the Guitar Hero 3 version of that album was significantly better in mastering. And
can you buy that version? Is that the version that's been released now?
I'm sure that there is a remastered version on all the streaming services, and probably the only way you can find that original, because there was such a huge backlash, and it did. It sounded like crap.
It did, and at the time, I didn't really notice. I didn't really understand how to tell, but I've listened to, and ever since I heard about the Guitar Hero 3 version, I was like, well, I'm just going to listen to this because I know that it's better intellectually, despite mm-hmm. recognizing very little about that at the time, and I have listened to them both compared to each other in the last like year or so, and that original release is it. Mess.
Really?
I remember learning things about mastering. I bought that CD like the day or a couple after it came out. Excuse me if I told this story before on this channel. But and I was listening, I know what car I was driving, and I listened to it, and I got a few songs in, and I'm like, I'm tired. Like, my ears are tired from this. What is going on? And then like I started thinking about it. I'm like, oh, Chris, this is master bus compression.
This is what overcompression
like,
is.
Like, and anyway, so
no, that's really interesting. I'm, you know, we've actually, it's interesting, but over the last few days, I feel like we've been getting more comments of now you have to listen to Death Magnetic. That's what people are saying. So like,
because
I don't
know. All Nightmare Long song is like,
good
it's
stuff.
So good.
The funny
I
thing about
that song, Death Magnetic's a good album.
It is good.
When it came out, I was a little bit elitist about it, and I was like, oh, they're just parodying themselves. Like, this is really inauthentic, and they're just like, oh, they heard a bunch of fans say that they wanted 7-minute songs, and so now all of them are like that. And I don't agree with that so much anymore. I just There's a lot to like about that album, I think.
I think that 72 Seasons is going to be even worse. I think that it's going to be like Ride the Lightning riffs. I mean, which was basically, was Lux Aeterna the first one that came out?
Yes. I haven't heard the second one. I just heard Lux Aeterna.
And I think maybe I have avoided listening to it from your influence, but
yeah. Well, I wanted to save it for our reaction because I knew we were going to do this.
Yeah.
I just want to say real quick that I had a whole thing planned that I was going to do for this video that I didn't do because we've been talking and having a good conversation. But I was going to do this whole shtick about how we're listening to the Black Album. And by Black Album, I mean Black Celebration by Depeche Mode. I was going to like make the files and like change the, I was going to rip this CD, change the files to the name so that when we actually got to listening, we would be listening to this album instead. And I was going to go real hard into that. And the reason I was going to do that is because everybody, it's freaking Depeche Mode week. We get new Depeche Mode on Friday, people. Alert the presses. They don't seem to know because people aren't freaking out enough about this. Okay.
I want to see the Venn diagram of Metallica fans and Depeche Mode fans and see if they ever even touch.
I don't give a crap. This is my channel, and if you don't like Depeche Mode, you're wrong, first of all. If you think that Metallica is better than Depeche Mode, you're absolutely kidding yourself. And if you think Metallica is like a great band, you should go listen to some Depeche Mode. Talk about a band that deserves to be in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, and you're talking about Depeche Mode, not Metallica. Get out of here with that.
Boy.
But seriously though, this is the first Depeche Mode album in 5 years since 2017 Spirit, which I've been listening to Depeche Mode nonstop Depeche Mode this week, which is great because this is their 15th album, so I have 14 of their albums I can listen to up to this point, including all their live albums and all their crazy stuff, plus all the vinyl that I have and everything. I absolutely love this band. They're phenomenal, and I'm so excited to live in a time where I'm doing my YouTube reaction channel and we're going to be getting a new Depeche Mode album, because it is highly likely that I would have done this entire reaction channel thing over a few years, you know, whatever, and then I would have got killed walking across the street or something, hit by a car, who knows what, and never have been able to react to a Depeche Mode album. And I'm gonna get to react to a Depeche Mode album, and if that wasn't good enough for you people, it's also the release of the brand new Ellie Goulding album this Friday, and I got my deluxe.
I don't think anybody heard what you just said. I certainly did not.
I'll boost the audio in post. The new Ellie Goulding album also comes out this week, Chris, and I've got my deluxe autographed copy from Amazon coming to me in the mail probably sometime next week. But since I'm not a Prime member, it'll probably take 2 weeks because they want to screw with me. But, you know, I'm not going to sign up for Prime. Amazon, you can't get me to do that, okay? I don't need it. I don't want it. So, anyway, I just wanted to say I had a whole shtick planned with Depeche Mode and their album called Black Celebration from the year that we were all born, 1986.
You could have done Jay-Z.
I'd love to
too.
See, like...
You're right. There's lots of black albums, but I wanted to do
one
that
was
really
like
good.
A super cut of every time you've mentioned Depeche Mode
in all these videos.
Not...
be longer than any of the 3-hour videos that get put out anyway.
Honestly, though, you guys don't understand. Okay, Metallica releases albums every, like, what, 3 years? Come on.
It's
Depeche Mode
seven.
Every 5 years. Oh, okay, whatever. But still, still, this is a big deal that we're getting a new Depeche Mode album, and so... But I'm also excited for Metallica, and I'm also excited for us to finally get to listening to the Black Album. You can't see any... Let's talk about this album artwork for a second, shall we?
There's a snake.
There is a snake.
Is this where the Don't Tread on Me thing started?
No, it's... the song is in reference to a flag from a, you know, it has existed for quite a while. They just have a song about it.
Okay. I was curious.
It's
I honestly
way
don't know.
Older than that.
Well, I figured, but the fact that they have a song called Don't Tread on Me and that the symbol of the flag, the snake is like a symbol of Don't Tread on Me. I just maybe thought that it was a Metallica thing. I don't know.
Huh.
So I was curious about that. But also, this has to be some of the worst album artwork of all time.
I would disagree.
It's just black. It's just black.
It says Metallica in the top left.
It does.
I know that.
Snake in the bottom right.
I know that, but it's stupid.
No, it's not.
I don't like it. For as cool as their other album covers were, okay, Ride the Lightning
and
Master of Puppets is so cool. And I agree. I don't think And Justice for All is as good as those two. And I don't care for the Kill 'Em All. Actually, I do kind of like the Kill 'Em All. It looks like the cover of a Stephen King book or something. Which I don't know if that was intentional or not, but that's kind of the vibes it gives me. And I'm not a big Stephen King fan, but like it looks like the cover of like a cheap horror novel or something, I think. Yeah. But I don't know. I like that too. Way better than this.
I think that I like the Anjustice artwork as artwork, but as an album cover, I don't think it's as good as Ride the Lightning or Master Puppets.
Sure.
I mean, the drawing is cool, but like,
I think this works really well as like an indication of a change of direction.
I think that that's
okay. That's a good legit thought. But this to me seems like way darker and more like, like this would be more like a black metal album than, you know, Ride the Lightning could be anything. You know what I mean? The artwork again.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, this is just like a sort of like an abstract, like you got to hold it in the light to see the snake, you know, just
it
in the right way.
It has definitely launched itself as far from the 80s as it can try to get.
That is
via 1991.
That is an interesting
That's actually
thing.
A great point. That's actually a really good point. It doesn't feel 80s at all.
Mm-mm.
Those pictures. I mean, how many of those t-shirts have you seen throughout your life with their four faces and right?
I've never seen Metallica one of those.
Logo. I don't think ever once.
Huh.
Unfortunately. I would take one if I saw it.
This is from the remastered version. It's the exact same booklet with a little bit of different stuff. But we do get some extra photos in the deluxe edition here.
Huh.
So this is before they cut their hair, right? We talked about that in one of the videos, that that was like a big deal that they cut their hair. This is before all that. So this is still real true Metallica. I just wish that I could... Oh, I'm just saying. Like, I wish that I could like transport myself back to like understand. Like, I feel like Metallica, more than any other band I've like reacted to, it's sort of important that you understand at least a little bit of the story of Metallica to like grasp it. You know what I mean?
I think that people pick apart that.
Oh, you think it's less important than it actually should be, maybe?
I think it's interesting that they have so much of a story, because that's so rare for bands to have such a like, I don't know, it just, there's so much turmoil for them as a band after Black. Like, it's just right. Everybody alive has an opinion of, like, pre and post Black Metallica, it seems like.
Well, but is it just because of the size of their band? And, like, that's the part of the thing that I don't really like about the rock and roll mythology stuff. Like, some of it's interesting, and I totally tell the Led Zeppelin stories and the Beatles stories and stuff that, you know, people know. But, like, all of that stuff, like, the part that I think is silly about it is that, I mean, before the Black album especially, and maybe even before Justice, like, these were just dudes that were, like, making metal music with their friends.
Yeah.
You know, and like, and nobody thought that it was going to be a big deal that, you know, whatever, they hit an anvil to make a sound. You know, there was an anvil in the space. Maybe they called away for one to be weird, but more than likely it was just there.
Right.
You know, like, I
think maybe it's a testament to how big the Black album is, that everything after that, like, my mom could tell you something about post-Black Metallica.
Oh, for sure. Know? That's something that Patrick is learning, that Metallica was actually quite a big band.
Yeah, I guess. I guess. To me, I always just thought that they were like a Depeche Mode cover band.
Right. They did a 300 date tour for this album.
Yeah, that makes sense.
That's pretty crazy. I mean, that is pushing the album as hard. Did this album like debut at number one and stuff? I guess I should have looked some of that stuff up.
I think probably. I was reading about it earlier and I didn't.
I like the speculative nature of these videos where we are completely fact free.
It doesn't matter. We're here for
reaction. It's all just like, you know, here's ideas for you to look up, listener.
Yeah,
we're here for reactions and to give satisfactions, and that's all it's about.
If you
guys
want to hit the old "let me Google that for you" in the comments, go right ahead.
No, I'll look it up. I've turned my internet off. Never mind, my phone's on airplane mode. That's all right. Don't worry about it.
Yeah.
Should we just try to listen to some of this?
Yes, we should. We should try to listen to the whole thing.
Okay. Now, unfortunately, one of the drawbacks to how we have everything set up with Chris here, though, I think it'll be absolutely worth it to keep you here, Chris. We're going to have to listen to things separately on your end and on our end. So the bad thing is we're going to be able to talk a little bit during the songs if we want to. I have a feeling that it might end up being you and me talking a lot. So Chris Parker, I'm so sorry if you ever feel like a third wheel or like you're off by yourself.
Yeah.
I feel like a majority of our talking to you will be after the song. However, we'll see. If we're listening and you can hear us and we can hear you and everything is working great, then we can keep the conversation going and talk over the music the entire time, which is the whole goal of these videos, to just troll Metallica fans. That's all we're here to do.
That's, yeah.
I've actually heard all these albums many times and I've just been doing a really good job of pretending.
When we've all taken acting classes in the last couple weeks, so like our facial expressions.
You should have noticed us getting much better. much better.
Metallica, this album debuted at number one in 10 countries.
Okay.
And stayed at number one for 4 weeks.
Wow.
Which is a long time.
Yeah.
It's probably a really...
It is a certified 16 times platinum album.
Wow. That's crazy. That's got to be...
16 million copies.
That's got to... That's probably the most copies of a metal album that's ever been sold.
And they probably... Oh, yeah. And they probably still get a platinum certification every now and then because people are still buying them from Walmart.
You know what I just read the other day? Metallica bought their own vinyl pressing plant.
I saw that.
Did you see that? That's crazy because we were talking about them and how they have all their vinyl and all the, or maybe we weren't. I was talking about this with someone. You can go to Walmart and find all Metallica's vinyls just there at every Walmart. And it's like, I guess they're big, but like, I can't find every Taylor Swift album there. I mean, but that's probably because of her issues with her legal stuff. But like every Beyonce album and Jay-Z album and Bad Bunny, he's like the number one artist in the world right now. Like, I can't find his albums there, but Metallica, you can go to any Walmart, at least in the Midwest where we live, and you can buy Master of Puppets and Justice for All, Ride the Lightning vinyl for $20. And it's like...
Here's an interesting fact. In December 2019, this album became the fourth release in American history to enter the 550-week milestone on Billboard Top 200. So it's been on the Billboard Top 200 for 550 weeks.
That is,
wow.
As of 2019.
That is over 10 years.
Yeah.
So we're going to be listening to the exact files from this exact CD that I ripped onto my computer. Look, it even comes in a little vinyl package. This exact CD we're going to be listening to. I ripped the files losslessly and then illegally sent them over the internet to Chris so that he could play the same exact files we have. So, Chris, are you ready to hit play on track one, Enter Sandman?
I am already shocked. Yes. I did not know that this album opened with Enter Sandman.
Enter Sandman, track one.
What? Wow. You really? Yeah. Wow. Okay.
Wow.
So maybe that's this great. Is going to be more of a Chris react.
This might be. Like, track one? Really?
Did you didn't know.
Sad Kid, but true is too. I have no idea.
Kid
the
Rock is on this album.
I know the Kid Rock is on this album.
I will fucking destroy you if you keep talking about Kid Rock.
So will the comment section. So...
I was going to listen to that version of this song so that when it started, I could sing the whole... Oh, I haven't even mentioned that. Listener, watcher, you're going to have to hear me probably say... I've never reacted to an album on my channel that I've heard before. So you're going to get to listen to me sing probably the choruses of most of these songs. So just be ready for that. You're going to get to hear me sing a lot.
Yes, lucky you and all of us.
All right, Remote Chris, are you ready to start this first track?
Yes.
We'll play it all the way through without stopping unless we start screaming or something, but I think we can play it all the way through without stopping. And then we'll talk about it afterwards. We'll pause after this song's over, okay?
Yep.
Okay, I'm going to hit play in 1, 2, 3. Oh, I need to shut this. That was really stupid of me to have open. That's all right. I didn't notice nothing. Okay. It gets louder. Could turn it up a little bit, I think. Listen to that bass. That's what a bass guitar sounds like.
It is, right?
Now, is the bass doing a harmony to the riff? It's not doing the main riff. Or is it? Oh, it's so good.
It is, like, undeniably good.
I just feel like I'm at a stadium eating a hot dog with some popcorn watching a baseball game
they
or a hockey
game
or a football game.
That's what they
game.
Were writing. That is BS.
I'm at a WWE event. Here comes the Sandman with his pop, his beer can smashing it on his head. With his kendo stick. I'm sorry, his Singapore cane, because we're in ECW. Zop. You know, he hasn't done that as much as I expected him to do it on all the albums we've heard. So I'm curious if this is kind of where that comes from, this album.
The kick drum is not obnoxious.
It's not. I'm shocked. It's not. You're right. Ooh, the whisper spread total wide there. So far, though, there have been no really vocal overdubs, just mostly just his straight one vocal in the middle. other than those whispers there. More of that Godsmack whammy bar.
It's a wah pedal.
Oh, sorry.
I'll just correct you on that
no,
one.
No, no, that's fine.
That
yeah. Harmony vocals there. The guitars feel very wide. And that could be more of a mastering thing, too, to bring up the outsides. Lead guitar panned a little bit off to the side, too, right? I think so.
Left side?
Yeah. Well, my is reversed, so it'd be right side. My stereo image is reversed.
Yeah, it is a little bit to the right.
That's an interesting choice.
That's Kirk's side.
I guess. Here we go. This is my favorite part.
It is not.
Now I leap down to sleep. I pray the Lord. You're ruining it for everyone, Patrick. Down to sleep. Now I leap down to sleep. Pray the Lord my soul to keep. Pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I die before I wake. If I die before I wake. Pray the Lord my soul to take. How many takes of that you think they did for James?
50
takes.
That this is a cool vocal. That deep, lot of vocal overdubbing here. It is completely different from everything we've listened to, though. Really, I mean, there isn't the complexity. I mean, I know that that's like what it is. But, like, there isn't the complexity isn't here that has been there before.
Right.
That's interesting. Oh! What is that sound? It's not a. It's like a. Oh! Is it a word?
That's a patented Hetfield noise.
Oh! I know that this song fades out. Won't I look like an idiot if it doesn't? But I'm pretty sure it does.
I'd give anything for it to
not. Yeah, it does. It does. It is. That guitar that's in there is kind of interesting.
Oh, on the phasey stuff on the vocals at the end?
Boy. This is a real fade out. This is a let's take a whole minute to fade the song out fade out.
Huh. Well, that's a lot different than everything else you've listened to so far.
It is. But man, it was good. Right?
It was.
Now, I will say the mix to me is not like super stellar. It's not like the greatest thing I've ever heard. And I didn't think that it was going to be. But for as big as this album is, I guess I would probably think that it would be a little bit better. I mean,
Can you think of other albums from this same time period that you know to be significantly better mixed?
This is one thing we've talked about a lot. Like I have very
Far Beyond Driven.
By what? By who?
Pantera.
Oh, okay.
That rips.
I don't know them well enough.
That's my issue too. Like I just don't have very many references for anything from that we've been listening to, you know, in the Ride the Lightning video, I was shocked that there was any double bass because I didn't think double bass existed till like 1995. So like that's kind of been why it's been fun for me to do these reactions. Cause I just like legitimately did not know. And I was talking to Chris in the last video, Chris, that, I was listening to a little bit of Carcass and a couple of other just like 80 like thrash bands as well. I just told Google to play thrash music, and she played Carcass and Municipal Waste and or Municipal
Municipal. Say like a normal person.
Municipal waste. And I like to go into the vestibule when I walk into the front of the building. but anyway, like hearing those things, and that now I'm just like, I feel like now all over like YouTube and whenever I look up stuff, I'm just like, man, there was way more heavy bands way for a longer period of time than before I thought that there was. Does that make sense?
Yes, mm-hmm. Patrick. I've been trying to tell you this for the last 15 years.
I know. And it's just weird. Like I, for a long time, I thought that all music made between 1989 and 1999 was absolute trash. Like, the 90s is by far my least favorite decade of music.
Oh, wow. What a terrible
take.
No, it's a terrible take.
It's not. I was there for a lot of it, and it was awful. Just go listen to Alanis Morissette for 5 seconds.
Exactly. Go listen to Alanis Morissette for, like... It's all awful. That 90s alt-rock stuff is great.
But what I was going to say, though, to be serious, but I really did dislike my 90s music for a long time, and I still would consider it my least favorite genre of music, but I am getting a lot more of an appreciation for the, like... garagey feel of the 90s and like the like do-it-yourself kind of vibe of that, the way everything sounds. But the interesting thing about that is this came out in 1991 and this feels nothing like that. This feels very studio produced. This feels very tight and very, you know, it feels really good.
If they weren't already, Metallica was about to be the biggest rock band probably ever.
Right. And it's crazy.
Would you say that this album is timeless? In the way it sounds?
I don't know if I could say that any more about any album.
I don't think that I don't think that this sounds dated. I mean, it doesn't sound like Kate Bush.
What I mean more so is like, this doesn't sound anything like 1991.
Now remember, we are listening to a remaster. And I'm sure that a lot of work was put into this one, you know? And I do think that,
there's no way that the remaster makes enough of a difference to change how I feel about that, at least.
You're probably right. That's probably true. But worth mentioning, I think. I don't know.
My biggest gripe is the snare drum.
It's not big enough for you anymore now?
No.
It's not loud enough?
It's like a ghost of a snare drum in there.
To be honest, really? I did not hear the snare drum once. I wasn't paying attention to that
because it's barely there. There's like nothing. There's like...
And we established...
I find it to be... I think it feels very appropriate. I wouldn't
disagree with that. I do.
For snappy.
Basically, what I want in music is just really fast distorted guitars and like a snare drum just banging me on the forehead on every measure and maybe
you
more.
You must
than
be a
that.
Huge St. Anger fan then.
No.
Yeah, I don't know.
I will say what Patrick said about how this album is all kick drum did not resonate for me at all in that song.
Yeah, I don't know why I was thinking that. I don't know if it's because sometimes when I listen to music, I have like a little bit of a bass boost on my like CD player because it's lacking intentionally. And also I really like my Beats headphones, you know?
Shut up. if you were to create a drum kit that was physically sized individually in a way that it sounds on that album, you've got two toms that are the size of gongs that you could run through if they were made of paper. And then you've got a reasonably sized kick and then like, you know, like it may be a snare the size of a large pizza. But those toms are almost buildings all to themselves.
Which is interesting.
Toms sound great.
Right. And that makes sense because they're like the featured instrument of the song for a large portion of the song. The whole intro is just the, you know, the toms basically in the kick. And it's really interesting that they go back into that with the tom drums and the kick, and then they have the speaking over the top of it, because you would think that that would be too busy of a part to have that over the top of it. But it works so well.
Yeah.
You know, to have the speaking part.
I just wonder, this was the thing, like, I mean, I'm not exactly sure that I've ever listened to this album the whole way through. And I'm obviously way more familiar with, Ride the Lightning and Master Puppets and especially Justice.
Right.
Well, Justice or Master, not time for that. But how pissed would you have been if it was 1991 and you like listened to Ride the Lightning on the way to the record store, bought this, and the first thing that you heard was Enter Sandman? Like, as a metal guy, I would have been furious. Like,
I can understand.
It's a great song. I like it. And it's been 32 years since it came out. And I can say this now. But like, that is not a metal song. Right. It is a rock radio song. And it's a great rock radio song. And I love it. Right. And like, I have like screamed it at the top of my lungs a bajillion times. But like, I understand why, like, the outrage, because that's outrageous.
It is crazy, especially. But at the same time, I can also see how the band that made And Justice for All could make that.
Oh, so, yeah, for sure.
You know what I mean? And I know that's not what you were saying, but like, there's a huge difference between Ride the Lightning and And Justice for All, I think.
Mm-hmm.
I definitely think that maybe they're slightly more similar than And Justice for All is to. Well, if you took out. What's the first and last song on And Justice for All?
Blackened
and
Dyer's Eve.
Right. If you took those two songs away, you wouldn't have a, you know, 182 beats per minute thrash song.
There's a lot of songs, or at least a couple of songs for sure, on Justice that really foreshadow the direction they go with Black, I think, big time.
But like, in my metal elitist brain, I cannot call And Justice for All anything but metal. But like, that is not. I mean, this doesn't matter. This is genre stuff, and it doesn't matter. But like, I can understand why people were like, because if you had no idea, and like, how would you? Because there wasn't the internet back then,
right?
Mm-hmm. I mean, I was a child, but like, I can imagine like going and popping that in, and like being all pumped up, and you're hanging out with your buddies, and like, new Metallica, and then you go and buy it, and you're like, what in the?
Yeah, you're looking to start a circle pit in the backyard with all your friends, and it's like, Sandman's not going to get it started.
No. Like, and like, right away, and after you heard it 50,000 times, like, we were all kind of like bobbing our heads.
But
because
I think,
how can you not?
I think the thing to keep in mind, though, is that do you think more people bought this album that had never heard Metallica before than had heard Metallica before this album came out?
On the day of release?
No, I just mean in general.
In general, I think it would have to be the case.
Yeah, but when the outrage started, like, why would you go buy this if the last thing they turned out was Justice?
But people wouldn't be hearing the outrage if they didn't know Metallica. That's what I'm saying. Like, this album is the way that it is because of people who didn't know Metallica before this.
I don't know. I would have liked it, I think.
I think it's close enough to, like,
if you think about, like, Harvester of Sorrow and... I think one other one.
The one that was my favorite was.
I mean, right, Harvester of Sorrow basically says.
But what's
sad,
the song before Harvester of Sorrow?
On the next record.
Exactly, doesn't it? How they're just. It's just such a different type of metal. It's like this. The thrasher stuff that they built their career off of has sort of transitioned out into something that they really made, I think, popular for themselves, is their ability to like do really, really simple, effective stuff that is as heavy as a neutron star. And you just like plodding like through a big field of mud up to your waist, trying to it's just such a sludgy, heavy sound. And I think that they started to get it in Justice, and then they're just like, let's distill this in like a clinical produced way, probably through Bob Rock, who was like, oh, this thing that you guys are doing here, let's do a bunch of that. Mm-hmm. Like, and they just do it so well, because it's like, there's no, you know, the Sandman riff, Sad But True, like there's nothing fast or technical about any of this, but it's just such a like a big, heavy, you know, you make your stink face like
yeah,
for sure.
It's just interesting to me. This is really fun for me because you and I talk about stuff all the time, but I talk to Chris about music a lot as well, but the conversations are completely different, and so it's really interesting. Like, it's really fun.
It is.
It's really fun, but also it's very weird for me because it's, you know, it's like my high school friends are meeting my college friends or whatever for the first time. It is really weird. But also it's just like Chris has a very like visual way of explaining things, and he very much like uses analogies a lot. And I usually get what he's saying because we're thinking the same way. Whereas you're a much more technical person. Like, you break things down a lot more technically, I feel. Right.
For sure. And
I could just listen to you guys talk about Metallica because clearly you both love Metallica for like different reasons and stuff, which is really fun.
But mostly nostalgia.
Yeah, for sure.
Which is, and that, I mean, I think that that's interesting. And for the viewers that, whatever, especially if you're coming to these videos and you're watching them as a Metallica fan and like, you want to rip into Patrick for saying that Ride the Lightning sounds bad. as someone who really likes Ride the Lightning, like, and I love it. And I love a lot of music that had really bad sounding recordings. But like that, I think that that's super interesting because it does in 2023, it sounds bad.
Right.
I mean, like,
I think that there's plenty of merit to that too. Like, I cannot stand punk music, and it's because 90% of it sounds like absolute trash. But that's like, that's part of the aesthetic of punk music that people love so much. It's totally a thing.
I love a lot of it. And like, as a person that is, I'm not like, I won't throw records away because the production is bad, like Patrick will. But, like, I like a lot of punk music. And some of it, I think that some of it does sound good. And a lot of it that I like doesn't. But it's really the songs thing then. And that's an important thing to realize too for the people at home, is that, like, at least Patrick and I, and probably Chris to some degree, I just don't know. Like, when you become trained to be, especially through formal training, to like do audio stuff, especially when it's about music, a big part of it is being able to separate your brain from the music and the way that things sound.
Yeah.
And that's why, like, you know, I had a friend in college when we were in audio school together, like, basically tie me to a chair and make me listen to Nickelback because he's like, it just sounds so good. And like, and I did, and I like kind of died a little inside as that was happening. But I'm like, oh my God, it does really sound good.
Nickelback's not without merit. Like, Side of a Bullet is a banger, straight up.
Like, but it's just like
very proud to know I don't know what that is.
But it's just like I was telling you recently that you needed to listen to that Enrique Iglesias album.
And I did.
And it's phenomenal.
Yeah.
It sounds so good.
It does. But like, some of it too, it's like you just, I'm like, I expected it. Like, there was nothing surprising to me about
that.
Yeah,
but so much pop music doesn't sound that way. Go listen to the first Kelly Clarkson album.
You mean the one with the...
with all the hit songs?
Because that one... but, and like, whatever.
No, the songs are great, but the mix is trash. I have when that album first came out, I bought it. And I guarantee you they did not keep that version of the album out for very long. They had to have... I should do research into this. But like... I have the original pressing of that CD, and I bought it. I got it at prom. They had a bunch of CDs at prom, and we played games, and you won points, and you could get stuff. And that's how I got one of my favorite albums of all time, Matchbox 20's second album,
Yourself,
or third album.
Or Someone Like You, that one?
No, not that one.
Oh.
I hate that album. But 3 a.m. Wake Up Call is the one that I dislike. But anyway, the Kelly Clarkson album sounds terrible. The mixes are awful. But when you listen to them on the radio, they do not sound like that. Someone went back in, and because she was just the person that had won American Idol at that point.
And so they cranked out a record.
Right. So they made an album as fast as possible. And then they had to go back in and be like, whoa, okay, this is blowing up. It's a huge, she's the number one selling artist of the whole year. And that album has like six, it has Breakaway. Since You've Been Gone. I Never Stray Too Far From the Sidewalk.
Oh, that one.
Because of You. And
that's
also,
that one. Yeah.
And also, I think that might be her second album, because her first album had that Walk Away. No, that is on that album too, Walk Away.
I think the album's called Walk Away.
Yeah, you're correct. But anyway, go listen. I don't know if you can find the original mixes of those songs on the internet now, because I'm sure they've been gone for a long time. They are atrociously
bad. I think it'd be tough to know if they were.
Yeah, well, yeah. Well, if you listen to it and it sounds good, you're not listening to the original version.
but it doesn't
anyway,
matter.
Anyway, sorry, you're right.
After the second time you've heard Since You've Been Gone, you will never hear the production again because you will be screaming along with it.
Right.
And I am...
But you're right. The first day when we were in class, the very first day, do you remember what our professor said? He said, if you're here because you like music and you want to make music, you should just leave right now. Because what's going to happen is when you graduate, if you're lucky enough to graduate from this course, you will hate music because you'll understand it intrinsically on a level that you don't want to understand it on. And that's why I know so many people who do not listen to music but are in the music industry. Right?
Yeah.
People that are in bands and just don't ever like to listen to music. Or my old boss hated music and he ran a recording studio, you know?
I think that's a little bit.
That's a little different, but whatever. Yeah. For the purposes of my point, people don't know all those extra things about him. but the idea, the point I'm trying to make is like, yes, you're taught to listen to things and to isolate things and mixes and like to think about things in a different way than the normal person. And it's rare that I feel like it's more rare to be involved in the music business, at least from like a creating albums side of it, that you still enjoy listening to music. Like, so many people that are involved in the creation of music side of the music business, not necessarily the live performance business. Although we also have friends that do live stuff, like Jason, he hates listening to music, and he's been touring with Jimmy Buffett for like the last, you know, 6 years, and he's toured with no all wonder. These huge bands. Yes, I'm not gonna disagree.
There's a Rebecca Sugar is a cartoonist, and she did the show I can't remember the name of, but I heard once she had described the process of like what you're talking about, where you like learn, you get on the other side of the curtain. Mm-hmm. It's kind of like a donut, where like you start eating the donut, and that's your general consumption level of a thing that you like. And then, you know, hooray for us all, donuts delicious. And then you get to the middle of the donut, which is the hole, which is like, that's when you start learning the things about what goes into it. And you get to the point you're talking about where like, you'll never like music again because of all of the things that you learned. But then if you keep going, you get to a point where you start appreciating the things that people are doing to make stuff be the way that it is. Mm-hmm. As somebody who recognizes what it takes to make that happen. And it's a completely different level of enjoyment than you ever had on the other side of the donut.
Right. And it's not to say that it's better or more valid either.
No, that's absolutely not.
Because if you've watched a video of me reacting to anything on this channel, you know that that is the angle that I come to everything from. And I could listen to the, I've said this a million times. Chris agrees with me. Chris Parker agrees with me. I would much rather listen to the greatest produced album that was very poorly written rather than the greatest written album that was poorly produced. Which you do not agree with me on that.
I do not agree with that at all.
I have a hard time agreeing with the first part of that.
Ah.
But I really, really agree with the second part.
But still, but anyway, I'm just saying that's what my channel is, and that's why, because I'm not just sitting here like, oh, you know, whatever, like, that's what we're doing. We're analyzing it on a deeper level.
Do you pretend like you have a switch in your brain? Like, I absolutely do.
I don't. I never do.
Huh. Because I find it very hard to, this stuff, Metallica stuff is different because, like,
you've
I haven't
so
listened
long
to it. Right. It's been so long, and it's right. been a long time since I've, like, really listened to this stuff.
Right.
But, like, stuff that's new from bands that I like, I almost cannot flip the switch to production mode. It's very tough for me to, like, be like, what do you think about that snare drum, Chris? Why do you think this sounds so good? Because, I kind of don't want to, because, like, I like that feeling of being a dumb 14-year-old kid that's just like, this is awesome.
Yeah, I would say I don't do that because there's no music that I like that sounds bad. All the music that I like, I could say objectionably sounds fantastic. And that's because one of the reasons I like it is how good it sounds.
I think for me, a big part of it is that I don't music. Like, I can't write music. Mm-hmm. I don't play any instruments. Like, there's just so little for me to understand it. And I don't even understand entirely what goes into, like, really good songwriting.
How blessed are you?
Yeah. So production's what I have for stuff.
Right.
Yeah.
But
that's super, interesting.
In the same vein, actually, interestingly enough, I did write in my notes that, lyrically speaking, this album, I think, is a lot less direct and ultimately a bit more toothless than Justice is. Like, there's a lot of stuff about introspection and some sort of like floating ethereal concepts. Like, Sandman is about kids having nightmares, you know. But there's so many songs.
I wouldn't know. I've never heard.
I know
single
that
lyric.
Was just about to say. I'm so glad we have a lyrics guy now.
I'm not really. That's the thing. Generally speaking, I'm not very good with lyrics. I find them difficult to pay attention to if I want to pay attention to anything else in the song. But I mean, we're talking about Metallica, and Patrick, you were making fun of lyrics in the Justice video.
Bad.
They're not, though. That's the thing.
Oh, I guess
there's
I wasn't
so
paying
much
attention to him. So yeah.
Right. Well, because there's so much, like, James Hetfield's at his best when he's singing about depression and war, and especially Justice is like, there's so many political things in that album. That's like, you know, nuclear war and like the earth being destroyed, and then like things involving his parents, he goes back to that a lot, and having freedoms that are like, you know, you get all the freedom you want as long as it's what I say, I think is in A Justice or one of the other songs. And it's like, there's so much like really good strong timelessness in the lyrics of Justice, and all the songs on Black are like, you got a song about nightmares for children, and you've got a song about like Sad But True
Kid Rock.
Lyrically speaking, from the perspective of structure and how it tells this really...
Yeah, we haven't got there yet, sir. We haven't heard that song yet.
Okay.
But it is coming there's up.
Well, I'll bring them up as they go as we go through them.
Please bring that up. You must be right though, because that's the only way anyone could like the song one. Because you certainly don't like it because of the music or the way it sounds.
I disagree.
I
listened to it like two times while I was editing the video, and I was like, "There's nothing good here. There's nothing good here." I think it's the worst Metallica song. One is the worst, and I'm not even being like a joke. I'm not joking. Of every song I've heard so far Metallica do, one is the worst one.
That's a shame that you think that.
That is a shame that you think that.
But that's not true.
But you guys also know me. You know that like one bad thing in a song can ruin the whole song for me. So like, yes, it's really cool when he's doing the darkness imprisoning me. Like, that's cool. But I shouldn't have to suffer through the first 3.5 minutes of the song to get to that.
But it's what makes it cool.
I'm sort of with you on this.
I understand that from a certain angle, but I don't care. That's not you. Write a better first 3.5 minutes.
Look, I'm sort of with you on this, and I just sort of had this realization that one and Knights of Cydonia by Muse are effectively the same structure of song, where it's like you've got whatever's happening in the first half, and then you've got the breakdown into one of the greatest moments of like rocking music that have ever existed.
Right,
and it's like I'm not going to sit here and die on a hill of the first half of one as an excellent song. But the second half and like the breakdown into the rest of it is worth every single part of what happens before that.
That transition is like, that is the
it's thing everything
that gets people.
And like, I think, Patrick, I think you should listen to the S&M version of one if you've never heard it.
You should just listen. Okay. Have you heard S&M?
You showed me parts of it many, many years ago.
I have gotten ripped apart for liking that so much.
That's a bunch of bullshit. That album is incredible.
It's awesome.
Right. And you know how much I like it.
And then there was a Death Clock episode about it. And like,
damn right.
But everyone knows how much I like symphonic elements in metal music. So like, I definitely want to experience that at some point. But let's listen to Sad But True. Okay.
Yes.
Chris, are you ready?
No.
Okay, let me know when you're there and ready to go. Okay, 3, 2, 1.
It's so good.
All I can think of is the Undertaker.
Stop.
No, he's riding out on his bike, on his motorcycle.
There's a snare hit.
Oh, God, it's good.
Now the snare drum is there, though.
Now this is for the questions that don't have any
answers.
The midnight glances at the topless dancers. The gangs with the 40s and the chicks with beepers.
I'm glad I can barely hear you.
All my heroes in the methadone clinics. All you bastards at the IRS. The crooked cops and the cluttered desks.
Stop it! Now get in the pit and try to love someone.
I'm so happy that the volume on this, I can change it.
I just want to point out, yes, I know that was the first to Ba Wit A Ba, but I don't actually know the Kid Rock version of this good enough to sing the verse, okay? But it doesn't matter.
May you
Thank
never.
You, Patrick. You just grazed that street cred.
Because we can all agree Ba Wit A Ba is way better than whatever that song is, right? American Badass. Okay, sorry. Because I hear his vocals are doubled. Oh, there's a harmony part in there now. God, that is a cool riff.
It is.
Did you hear someone made a comment to us about how they didn't start using click tracks until this album?
Oh,
because Rick, was it Rick Ross? Bob Rock? Rick Ross? Who produced this?
Bob Rock.
Sorry, I get him and Rick Ross mixed up. Bob Rock like made them use a click track, and it really screwed Lars up, I guess.
Oh, it makes sense.
And so like, but that was one of the things they had a hard time with, because I guess they had a lot of hard times with this album because he wanted to do things they didn't want him to. They didn't want to do. You can barely hear the rhythm guitar on the right side at all.
I know. Right? On the correct right side.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, because I switched it. Yeah.
Even there.
It's there, but it doesn't have any high end on it.
Because it's Kirk's side, because yeah. Then the lead is over there.
Yeah. At least that makes sense on this album, remember? And Justice, it was all leaning to the same side. We're like, what the heck? Why would the delays be, you know?
Oh, there's a couple parts for
this. Yeah, there was a few parts where we were like, what the heck? Nah! What's that Kid Rock sound? Yeah! Little whatever he makes there. And then this is where Kid Rock does the actual guitar solo,
yes.
Right?
Kid Rock is playing the guitar solo.
Well, I know he plays the drums, the bass, the guitars, and sings on stage when they perform
this
song.
He's the greatest musician of all time.
Certainly better than Kirk Hammett.
Yes, indeed. Guitar, the solo's kind of buried.
Notice how every time he, like, accents on the snare, he's hitting a cymbal at the same time? I noticed that there. Every time he accented on the snare, he was hitting a cymbal, too.
Okay.
Let's pay attention to that. Whoa.
A hi-hat hit on every big snare hit.
Yep. Hi-hat's right in the middle, too. Right?
Maybe.
The whole overheads sound very splashy. Oh, that's right. I forgot. That's how the song ends, too, though, right?
I think so.
Dude, the echo vocals are so badass. Oh, it's so cool.
The hi-hat is in the center.
Yeah. And it's wide open, too. There you go. Hear that. Open crashes to end the song out. And that extra little low boomy bass in there.
I was just thinking, there's so nice, really nice, deep, beefy bass right at the end of that.
Yep. I love that song.
How can you not?
Do you like it better than Enter Sandman?
There.
Yes.
I would say I do as well.
I can't compare those two things.
Yeah. I think Enter Sandman would be better. I really dislike the way the clean electric guitar sounds on Enter Sandman. I actually despise it. I think that it sounds so... That, to me, sounds very 90s. The way that guitar sounds.
Okay.
You know, and I'm
talking about, like, the main, like, opening
yes,
riff?
Yes, yes. Yeah. Like, I've complained about Metallica's clean electric guitars several times because I don't like... I think that...
I don't think you like clean electric guitars.
Oh, I definitely don't. No. But, I mean, unless it's, like, twangy country or something like that. But yeah. Other than that, there's not a lot of... It's tough, though, because, like, if they're doing something slow, I feel like I would appreciate it more. But when they're doing something like that, I feel like, I don't know. I don't know what I wanted it to sound like, but...
I never thought about that sounding dated before. I guess it kind of does, but to me...
Well, there's a lot of effects to it. It's very wet with whatever's happening, you know? There's lots... It's like a chorus effect, basically.
Yeah.
I mean, it is a chorus, I think, effect. It probably was even a chorus pedal or whatever, right?
Yeah.
Because I'm sure they did a lot of post-processing on this album, too.
But one thing that I did notice about guitar tones that I don't think we've heard in the last two albums is that, like, on... It was happening some in Sandman, but it was different. But, like, on this, like, there are just parts where there are heavy guitars going on, and then there's, like, this layer with a phaser or a chorus
yes.
thing that just, like...
Yep.
It has been a surprise, and we talked about this on Justice, like how much production stuff was, we talked about it in this video, how much
yep.
production, and this thing's the same way. It's a little more subtle.
But to me, that the inclusion of that aspect to it makes it sound so much more modern. Because Chris Parker, you and I have talked a lot about that mid-range soup that I talk about on my channel all the time. That if you take away the guitar, bass, drums, vocals, the lead guitar, like the main guitar riff, drums, bass, vocals, what's left? right? And in all modern music, there's just this bed of this mid-rangey, reverby thing in there somewhere. It's like all modern music has it.
It does.
And that was not present on any of the three previous Metallica albums.
No, because they're metal records.
Right, 100%. It was just a much... And that's what I mean when I say something... It sounded more like raw and stuff. Because it's just much more like what you're seeing. If you saw them, what you're seeing is what you're hearing. Whereas this, there's so many more layers of complexity to the mix. Not even if it's just one or two extra things in there. There's extra layers. There's extra things to listen to. And it all works to thicken the mix so much, I feel, on both of these songs so far. And to me, that's like one of the biggest differences between this and the two and the three albums we heard so far. And that's why I like this way better.
One of the things that they do so well that I think is exemplified in this album is how they use space. And they use... They're so good at using space. Like... That pause between, you know, that...
Yes, we all know what you mean when you say that pause.
There is 100,000 miles of just years nothing. Of space between in that pause. They really make you wait.
Dun, 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 dun. Yes.
And then
yes.
that first note, like there is nothing... That is a... I can pick up a guitar at Guitar Center and go... And get like 80% of that note taken care of because it's so simple. But the effectiveness is just as good as it gets. That is the ultimate example of like elegant simplicity.
Yeah, it is.
And the idea in the first two songs of this, and like Metallica is a guitar band, and that's not really to be argued. Right. But on the first two songs on this record, the toms are a giant part of...
Yep,
there's
true.
Stuff like kind of like that on Justice 2. But then the snare drum is... I mean, that riff, the guitar riff is so good, but without that snare part, which is also just really simple, but like...
Crazy the more I was listening... Sorry.
No.
Speaking of the snare, I mentioned... Every time he's hitting the snare, pretty much, it's like a crash cymbal or there's some sort of an accent thing. And it wasn't every time, but there were large chunks of the song where he was playing very simple, but every time he hit the snare, he hit a crash cymbal too.
But you like that because...
I did like that.
No, you just like...
Oh, just like in general, yeah.
Because, right, how many times have we been making records and then we're just like, oh, God, I guess we'll just go put 1,000 more cymbal hits in here because, like, where else are you going to get high frequency from?
Every time,
that's
100%.
Such a good point. And it's interesting, too, because they're... One of the paragraphs that I was going to put in my complaints to you in the Lightning review... was that you both like had this sort of agreement period about whether or not Lars is a good drummer. And I think like there's just not really a ton of evidence for the fact that he isn't one. Mm. And I think the thing that he's best at is like composing the drum parts. And this is like a perfect example of why he's so good at that, because it's like there is such a level of simplicity in what he's doing, but the way that he's accenting and what he's doing with the snare to really just hit these parts of the song right into you like a nail. It's like, that's all really intentional, and it works so well for what it is.
Yeah, and I wonder, too, like, as I was mentioning when the song was going there, like, that they had trouble because they were using metronome on this album and stuff. Like, I wonder if, because they were a band that was known for being so fast and heavy for their first three albums, like, would Lars, when they played this live, did they want to speed every song up and play it faster?
No, they do regularly speed things up quite a bit live. And I've always thought that they did it intentionally. I imagine so, being the level of musicians they are. But, like,
yeah.
I wouldn't be surprised.
One of our comments on one of our videos said that one of the songs was so fast, they played it in the studio slower and then sped it up afterwards. Did you read that comment?
I can't. That would be like would be a huge no-no to do.
Well,
that.
It was some. It was like the person who commented, and I'm sorry, I don't remember who it was, but it was a really good comment talking about how they, for one of the songs in particular, they wanted to do something specific, and they wanted it to sound a very specific way, so they recorded it and then they like pitch shifted it down or something, or something they did with it that was very, would be considered kind of like a no-no. But that has come out in recent years, and that's why they don't play it as fast or something live or something. It was some... I'm so sorry, I don't remember the exact comment. Everyone go look at all the comments of all our other Metallica videos to see what it was. But it was something like that. But specifically, like James won, they did it. They like agreed to do this, whatever the process was. And then I don't know if like Lars played drums over the fixed thing, or if they, because you would know if you pitch it. Well, it depends how much they did it, but. Anyway, I don't know what I'm talking about, so I shouldn't be talking about it that long. But are we ready to move on?
Let's do it.
Yes.
Chris? Okay.
Yes.
Track 3, Holier Than Thou Art.
You are.
Okay, ready?
Yep.
3, 2, 1. Right, here we go. Now this feels like Metallica again. Those tom hits to accent.
And the mouthy guitar thing.
Lead guitar's on the other side too now. It was there for me.
Oh yeah, the talk box.
Talk box.
Oh, the talk box.
I'm a guitar player. Dude. I just couldn't make the word come out of my
mouth. Bon Jovi.
That's definitely like a load reload precursor big time.
Fast hi-hats rather than slow. That would give this a much different feel, you know? Mm-hmm. It's a... That was really interesting.
One of the things I love about James Hetfield is how he starts a verse and it sounds like it's the second line. Like, that is... I love it. I love it so much.
No, you're
much.
Right. I absolutely get it. I know exactly
what
you
so
need.
Good.
Oh my gosh, yes. Holy cow, yes.
They did some stuff to make him sound more in tune on there, right? There's some double tracking and effects going yeah. on those longer notes.
Dude, that you know not. That's so, that is so previous Metallica, you know? Ooh, that might have been two harmony parts there, yeah. Okay, now the lead guitar is over on the other side again.
It was
and
just a
way
talk
back.
Oh, the talk box
yeah.
somewhere.
Howdy vocals, that's yeah. new, right? Like gang vocal kind of thing. That's not really on any of the other ones. Not like that.
You are.
Like all the rhythm guitars in the left, though.
Pretty much, yep.
Like there's a ghost of it over in the right, but like, I can't say that I like that.
I really think it's just because they took the high frequencies out of that side. Because it would sound too one-sided, and it's not bothering me as being over... unbalanced, really.
And presumably, with that being true, then you would tell that this is a James solo, because it's still over there.
Maybe it is.
That's a great... And now this is not. This is back to Godsmack.
And kind of to the right. A little tiny bit.
Yeah. Oh, definitely.
Well, maybe more than a little bit. There's reverb really far to the left.
Yeah.
First time.
Yes.
We were talking about that thing specifically last time.
Yes. They felt bad about what's his face? Jason Newsted. We'll give you a part on this album where they can hear you. Dude, without him, this album would not sound probably... I don't... Like, the bass is a big part of why this album sounds the way it is. All the plodding feel and stuff. That's in the guitars, but it's also in the bass. Is that the end of the song?
Yeah. That one just flies by.
Oh, we're getting to some good
See,
stuff
so
coming up.
Oh, my God. Oh,
real
but
quick.
Like, yeah.
Oh, because there's two things that I missed when I about Sad But True. One, the lyrics sort of tale that I was going into before we started listening to it. Like, there's the whole entirety of that song, there's this ambiguousness, this ambiguity to who you are when he's talking about I'm this, you know, or I guess who he is. I'm you're this, I'm you're that, and it's like what is the perspective of this? And you get to the end of the song, you get that reveal, I'm you, and it's like, oh, that's a really interesting way to structure the message of this whole song. And
that's really interesting.
To
know that
to your stupid Kid Rock mess. When I was 14, I heard that Kid Rock garbage, and at this point, I was already like. Huge Metallica fan, favorite band of all time. I heard that trash and I wrote them an email and said,
Good job, Brass.
Did you know that Kid Rock took your song and turned it into garbage and they're just playing it? Like, I couldn't imagine that they just allowed this. He had to have stolen it. Like,
how much did that cost?
I don't know.
Oh, it had to cost a lot.
Do you think it cost more than Kid Rock's version of Sweet Home Alabama?
No.
That is a great question.
We were trying different things.
It.
We were smoking funny things. Staying up all night.
Well, that one has two. I knew it has Werewolf from London. Werewolf in London at the beginning.
Oh, I don't even know what that
is.
Yeah,
that song.
I knew bringing up the Kid. I was like, I desperately don't want to revive the Kid Rock thing that we have since forgotten. But I really wanted to tell a stupid story.
No.
Now we need to go back to forgetting.
No, I'm really glad that you said that though about the point of the lyrics. That's the kind of thing that, if I was sitting here reading the lyrics, that's the kind of thing that I would love. I love it when, like, the perspective of a song, like, when a song can kind of have, like, a bit of a twist ending to it.
Mm-hmm.
I really like that kind of a thing. So that's the kind of thing that I would really appreciate had I been paying attention to that. But
I didn't even notice it either until I watched a different, like, a set of reactors listening to it for the first time, and they came up with that, and I was like, oh, shit, that's very
That's awesome. Yeah, that's really cool.
So here's my thing, because I was so shocked that Sandman was the first track on this record.
Yeah, you skip it every time. I don't remember.
I remember my friends owning this CD.
Mm-hmm.
I don't remember myself owning it. So anyway, it doesn't matter. But you probably the whole Black Album controversy that happened could have been avoided if Metallica would have written a clean electric or acoustic opening to Holier Than Thou and put that at track one. And I think that history would have been changed forever. And but like
you might be right.
For a long time, I remember when I was like 8. And I like remember figuring out that on a bunch of albums that I liked at that time, that like the hit was song 3. So they could have made Sandman 3, right? If you would have went Holier Than Thou with an acoustic intro.
Yep.
To call back to Battery.
The previous albums.
And well, not.
Battery and Blackened.
Not Blackened.
Whatever the intro is, Master Puppets.
It's so much.
Battery. Yeah.
Battery is Master Puppets. What's Ride the Lightning?
Fight Fire with Fire.
Oh,
okay. And right. But then the whole right. You could have went Holier Than Thou with an acoustic intro, Sad But True, and then Sandman. And like that would have changed. That would have changed rock history forever.
But you know why they didn't do that? Because of what the next song is. So they wanted to go. They wanted to go mid-tempo, fast. Best song on the album. Just kidding.
Is that what you're about to say about this next song?
Another.
No, but I do really like the Unforgiven, but
it's fine. It just got listened to so much, and I actually think that this might have been like the senior song when I was in high school, which was like way after that, but like it's so gross.
Why
did you pick Battery?
But like legitimately though, it makes sense to come from what we just listened to, then going into like the slow. What we're going to hear next, like it makes sense.
Yeah.
So should we just listen to that one?
Yes.
Let's do it, yeah.
Okay, here we go. The Unforgiven, we wouldn't know this at the time, but The Unforgiven part 1.
Of 3?
I have not heard of 3. I did not know there was a part 3. Oh.
What is that sound at the beginning?
A bell of some kind?
The brrrr.
Oh, that's a trumpet, right?
That's what I would think too, but on a Metallica record? Yes, it is.
Now this sounds fantastic.
It does sound fantastic. It's so very wide.
Good, yeah.
No mono energy, right?
And they're
it's
not,
all
they're
stereo.
They're not banging on those acoustic guitars so hard their fingers are bleeding. They're playing it softer. Which is what I wanted them to do the whole time. And then this
I'm
sort
sure
of like
it's all James.
And then this like sort of Egyptian
the bass
feeling.
Sounds great. That's the Phrygian scale.
Right, we learned about that in music theory.
And Metallica always does it, and so does every other metal band now.
Well, we're gonna get that sort that one that song. Oh, the next track, Wherever I May Roam, right? Is the whole thing is based on that sort of scale? I remember thinking that was so heavy when I heard this, like because of what, like you said, context.
Drums are so compressed. and I think that kick is like sidechained to something. Because right, like the whole thing sucks
hold on,
down.
The
when
best
the
part's coming
okay,
right here.
I know you were gonna say.
Yes, oh my god, I love it.
What I felt, what I've known, never shine through what I've shown.
Patrick Shush. You're right, he's way better than me. I love this chorus.
So did every other basic bitch.
Nice harmony there at the end.
It is very pretty. And like long and reverby and bright.
Yeah.
It's nice.
There's a lot of those guitar chords are very, they're a lot more like fuller chords, right? Like it's not just a power chord, especially when it first comes in. There's more of a strumminess to it, right? Maybe not. Like it feels more like an AC/DC thing rather than
oh,
like a...
yeah, there's like that dyad thing. Yeah, yeah. They're doing higher
It's like
stuff.
A fuller chord, yeah.
Back there.
Yep. Dude, I love a chorus that's less intense than the rest of the song. It's that is so rarely done well. To have a chorus come down in energy, that is so rare.
Point.
I love it.
Demon Hunter
and there's a lead guitar part going the entire time as well. And he's not just singing that same thing. Like, it is an additional part.
Yeah.
Let us know in the comments all the amazing, like, bells and sounds and things they have in the back here. Because there's so many cool layers of things in this.
Mm-hmm.
This clean guitar stuff I don't mind because it's a little bit more muted and dry.
And how weird to hear the guitar louder on the right. Because the lead part is low.
But this lead part, though, there's so much room sound in that.
Yeah, it's huge. It's like far away.
Yeah, or it's the reverb or something they did to it after the fact.
But that's about a lot of the lead stuff has been.
Yeah, but this sounds a little bit more.
It is different, but.
It's kind of like you got to dig in there to find it a little bit.
Yeah, I think that's a dissonant mic with
reverb on it.
He's
like back here.
But it definitely has a stereo, full stereo reverb on it as well.
But it's all here, right?
Yes.
Yeah,
it doesn't go
like
over to the
six
right
degree from angle on from the center that he's been in the whole album.
Yeah.
And thank you, Lord, for going back to the chorus a third time. Do you know how easy it would be to have that guitar part be distracting? They're doing the intro riff the entire time over this, and it doesn't bother. And there's also a lot of moving acoustic guitars on the sides, and it doesn't feel busy. It feels less. It feels like the song has come down in energy, and there's actually way more happening. It's just not loud and distorted, you know? And they didn't do the thing where now do the chorus a second time and then have all the crunchy guitars come back in. They're not doing that. They're just letting it be what it is here. They're making it a little more complex, and they're adding layers of electric guitars behind it. You know, it's so common for a band to have a chorus like this, that's the lower chorus, and then on the last one to then bring it up and have them scream the chorus a little bit more or whatever when they're repeating it.
Damn it. I was thinking to myself, oh boy, this needs out, doesn't it? Does it? And then the board came up. Ah, yes, there it is.
You can't have a big single and not fade it out, come on. What year do you think this is, 1995? That's not a volume knob, that's a lot of faders.
Yeah,
at this time. That's everybody in the band on the board at the same time.
all 12 hands.
They didn't have that automation like we got now where you can just push a button and it, the ghost pulls all the faders down.
Yeah.
So I feel like we did a pretty good job of talking about that one. Chris, what are your thoughts there?
I've always felt like I like that song less than I should, but I can't like it more than I do for some reason. Never been able to.
Okay.
And here's the thing. I like Unforgiven 2 better.
How does that one go? What's that one?
I don't know how to answer that.
Okay, let me think about it for a second.
Good answer, Chris.
Let me just think about it for a second. I can't think of it in my head at this moment. But okay, so I just want to say to the audience real quick, we just spent a little while trying to get Chris's video to work a little bit better, but it must be the internet connection, something. It is not working very good. We know that. We see this. But his audio is getting recorded, and that's the most important part. It's kind of like we're doing a podcast.
That's basically kind of what these things are.
Well, we got a comment earlier today. A guy was like, why don't you just call it a podcast? Because I don't know if this is a podcast or if it's a reaction.
It's basically echoes
of the music room bounce around the walls in Ethereum.
You have to pick one or the other. And why, if it's a podcast, why don't you put podcast in the title so I know?
That's how he looks, too.
If the video's longer than 45 minutes, it's probably comparable to a podcast.
These videos
just write the word podcast on it in your brain.
And also, I just want you to know, if you leave us a good comment, maybe I'll read it with that really flattering voice that I just did. Don't you want me to read your comment out loud like that in a future video? But now let's listen to Wherever I May Roam.
Yeah.
Wherever I May Wander. I think that's a lyric in the song.
It is.
Okay, this is a longer one. Actually, the last track was pretty long, too. Is this the longest track on the album? It is. 6 minutes and 44 seconds.
No, it's not. My Friend of Misery is 6:49. 5 seconds longer.
Yep. Okay, they have definitely sold out, though, because there's not a single song over 6 minutes and 49 seconds. So, all right, you ready, Chris?
Yeah.
All right, 3, 2, 1. Yes.
I love it.
And is that a sitar?
It might be.
I thought it had to be. Way it's not. But.
Did they get someone to play the sitar on here, or did one of them play it? I'll look.
Sitar, like municipal.
Sitar, right?
That's how I would say it.
Oh, it's not sitar?
I want to know what that ghost sound is with the music crush like.
Yeah, is it something? Is it just a percussion sound, like slowed down something?
I love that. Is that double time, or is it just a little faster?
It reminds me of Mr. Grimm from Twisted Metal.
Yep, for sure.
Yeah.
It's a great riff. It's like. It kind of sounds like a China cymbal slowed down or something with some low frequency added.
Here comes more talking.
And the road becomes my bride.
Is it bride or pride?
I am stripped of all but pride,
right? We could do better than them. They're awful.
Gonna get screamed at.
All in good fun, people. It doesn't say in here anywhere who played the sitar or whatever that is. I will say, I remember when I was younger, this was my least favorite song on the album. Just because I didn't like the sort of like Egyptian feel to it, and Egyptian is probably culturally insensitive, I don't know, but like that chordal structure we were talking about,
yeah.
Like I just didn't care for that feeling, and I didn't really like the sitar, to be honest.
Huh.
Now I think it's probably one of the coolest parts of the album. It's so different. Mm-hmm. And this is a cool riff, too. A little similar to Sad But True, I guess. A little faster tempo, though. More tom drums. They're the star of the album. MVPs.
I agree. Yeah, the reverse.
Yeah, very cool. There was a that was a low harmony. Do you think it sounds like there's a cymbal hitting every time the snare plays because the snare has a gate on it, and when he hits it, the gate is open and you hear more of the hi-hat?
No, because there was a couple snare hits earlier. I was just thinking about that don't have cymbals and it sounded weird.
Okay.
There's a lot of snare automation going on too. It's quieter now than it was before.
Yeah. Ooh, that was a little bit of his Lars signature. That high harmony in there is so good.
Dead center.
Yep, it is. Yep. It is. Yep.
That's one cymbal way hard right.
Yep.
It's tickly. It's kind of cool that they do that.
So this is like a multi-part solo. Ooh, that
parts
was a
of this solo are very King Nothing sounding.
Yeah. That's one of the only other Metallica songs I know a little bit that came after this.
Yeah, that's low.
That and I Disappear from the Mission Impossible soundtrack.
That was one of my first favorite songs by them.
I might be in that same boat.
I love that song too. The music video is so badass too.
It is.
That was right at the same time Korn had that music video for those movie tie-in songs were really big. Sorry, you know we couldn't not talk about Korn, Chris. But Korn had that song, Did My Time, that was part of the Tomb Raider soundtrack with Angelina Jolie. Really
cool.
Right? Good stuff. Dude, this song is hitting hard. This is good.
Yeah,
there's a lot of compression going on, like you said, though. There's not a lot of moments where there's soloing going and vocals at the same time.
Yeah, why did this need a fade out?
Why does any song ever need to fade out?
I mean, some of them, I guess I kind of get why you do it, but like this one totally didn't.
Well, they're just having fun playing, and they didn't want it to end, and live they can do this. What? Why else would they do it?
Hard to find a
resolution. So you can say 94.9, The Rock. Like,
I've always wondered why anybody fades out. But
preaching to the choir there, Buster.
And see, now that song is about being on the road so much and enjoying it. And hooray for us all.
Like, right.
If you go back, you've got Justice, which has all of these, like, you know, political freedom, justice type issues. And then Master Puppets is all about, like, being controlled by the demon of drugs. And then Ride the Lightning has a lot more of that, like the For Whom the Bell Tolls is about people dying in war and all that kind of stuff. Like, there's so much more. All of these other songs have so much more teeth than the Black Album songs so far, I think.
Well, that's one more step into the we're going to make this as accessible as possible.
Right? I agree. I think so too.
Having your songs be more vague is much more accessible, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I've talked about that before with a lot of some of the bands that I really truly love. They don't sing about anything.
Mm-hmm.
They just don't. Remember when we did the first ever episode of The Music Room, Chris, which people who are listening, Music Room was a podcast me and Chris Parker used to have where we talked about music a lot, very similar to this. And then we would play for each other songs and then we discuss like the mixes and stuff. But remember when I read to you the lyrics of my favorite Interpol song and you were like, none of this means anything. Like it literally has no meaning whatsoever. There's no meaning. There's no hidden message. There's no It's just words put together. And I was like, that's one of the reasons I like it. Yeah. It doesn't mean a single thing, and it doesn't have to, and it doesn't matter. It's just a really
Might as well have been Lorem Ipsum, which would be a great set of lyrics for a song, to just read Lorem Ipsum.
Yeah, I don't know what that is, but sure.
It's the fill-in text.
Oh.
Like, if you go to a website where it's like, here's a bunch of things that look like words but aren't actually any words.
Sure, sure, sure.
But I will say about the lyrics thing is that, like, I know that Patrick and I especially aren't lyrics guys for the most part, because there are some song lyrics, not by Metallica, that, like, I really like and that I really find clever. And, like, I always think of that, oh boy, your head gets so full of stuff when you do this.
I know, it's hard to...
Anyway, that Three Wooden Crosses song. Love the crap out of that song.
I don't know if I know it.
Yo, you absolutely do. It's a country song. Oh my God, I can see the guy's face and I just can't think of his name.
What if Jesus comes back like that?
But anyway.
Too much hair.
But I will say,
hat.
But like Chris was, like Chris Parker was saying about like how the lyrics mean different stuff. But I think that like, especially when like Metallica is still a band and not all of the stuff that you hear is like even like, right, all of the music that you hear isn't even this organically produced. Like you've heard, God, was it a Rihanna record? Like somebody was telling the story about that and how it works. And you hired 30 producers that each bring in 10 songs and they split them up into groups of five. And then they pick out the top four or five songs that they like. And then it finally gets bubbles up to the top and they pick out the 12 that they're going to use for a record. Like that is so inorganic.
Right.
And like the guys that wrote the songs probably wrote them with meanings and stuff. Who cares? Doesn't matter. But like the fact that, you know, like the reason that one, like the music is the way that it is, and then therefore the production the way it is, especially that the band had a hand in the production and stuff. Like all of that stuff feeds into the things that I do like about music, right? Like the guitar riff, like Chris was saying earlier, like the guitar riff, the heavy one, the first heavy one in one. Like the reason that that's like that is because what the like it probably supposed to sound like machine guns kind of, or you know, whatever.
Yeah.
And like that stuff, it does have
contextual reasoning for it.
It does, even though I don't like care what the actual words are about. Like when the songs were being written, that like I bring this up and I'm sensitive to it a little bit because like I have in the past at school I teach school too. The idea of artistic intent gets brought up a lot. And a lot of the times students use that as a crutch, like when they want to do something stupid, like cut out the second verse of a song or like not go fix an error in a guitar solo or something.
It was because
it's artistic intent. And it's like the most bullshit reason ever.
Right.
That's my first swear. Chris has had like 10 today.
Yeah.
Anyway,
I will not be silenced.
You will be beeped.
You'll be beeped, but no, I wouldn't silence you. You will be beeped.
But that is a lot of what artistic intent is that like it doesn't have to do like, oh, somebody says the word time in the verse, so I'm going to put a TikTok behind that line or whatever. It's so much greater than that.
Yeah, it certainly can be.
Yeah.
100%. You're right. But I even think, too, just like the idea to have that song come after the song that we just had totally makes sense because of what I was talking about with that.
The album arc and stuff, too. We could talk for 50 hours about
the
art of making an album that is becoming lost.
Mm-hmm. It absolutely is.
Beyonce.
Chris, did you have anything you wanted to talk about regarding Wherever I May Roam?
Not really. I'm good.
You want to get to Don't Tread on Me?
Sure.
Sure. Let's do it.
Don't Tread on Me.
I know this album. All right. 4 minutes exactly. You ready?
Nice.
3, 2, 1. So that's a harmonized guitar part. I do too. I've always hated that.
That guitar sound?
It's a harmonized part, right?
It might be like
sounds like it was recorded in quonset or something. We won't have to hear it again.
It's
so
kind of a weird, like, sort of major scaly thing.
Yeah,
like
it did
in this
weird.
Heavy part, it's kind
of
weird.
I think it's supposed to be like, you know, evocative of patriotism.
I think that you're correct.
You know, son of a. Yep. That's absolutely, when you say that now, it's like, oh my gosh, yes.
Thank you, Chris Parker, for like giving us something other to talk about than.
Yeah, some actual context. Is this song facetious or is this song serious?
I think I was reading about what the meaning of this song is, and it's built a lot around, like, just, like, standing up for yourself and not falling to, you know, certain powers and influence and things like that. And I think in its original intent, it probably is to be meant to be, like, you know, not, don't be a Nazi, even though now the symbol has been so co-opted.
Dude, the guitars sound much heavier on this.
The guitar tone is a little different.
I feel like there's more on the other side as well.
Yeah, sorta.
Is this in the same key as the songs we've had so far? Pretty much?
I'm so bad at that game.
I mean, I don't know at all.
The breakdown in this song is one of my favorites in the whole album.
I'm enjoying this so much. Both the process of filming this video with you guys and also just listening to a damn good album.
Mm-hmm.
Little telephone vocals in there.
No.
It's still left heavy. It's still James heavy.
Oh, it is, but I feel like it was less so. This is a good vocal melody.
It is.
And I feel like it feels more like a verse or a lyrical part, a vocal part they could have had on a previous album. You know, not necessarily an anti-chorus, but he had a lot of those, like, I'm just going to kind of shout a few words, and it's not going to so much be a melody as it is like a statement. And that's what this is.
The end of this solo is possibly the heaviest thing on the show.
Okay. And he's playing the hi-hats as a gallop, or the, what do you call it? Instead of going, she's going, like a...
Oh, that's good.
That bass sounds so good. That is like metal bass. That's what you're supposed to do.
Trying to think of the term for that groove.
Swung?
Yeah, swing beat. He's playing a swing beat on the hi-hat there. There we go. Sorry, was there something I was supposed to pay attention to there?
Yes, there was.
Ah, whatever.
You missed that, your piece of garbage.
I didn't miss it. I was listening to it. I just was trying to focus on swing time. I think this sounds like the heaviest song we've heard.
I would disagree with you. I mean, it is heavy.
Do you think Holier Than Thou is the heaviest one?
No, it's sad but true, because every time, I don't know, Chris, if this is just a thing that I do, but like every time that like I think of the song Sad But True, like if it comes on the radio, like I turn it down if my wife's in the car and I say, "You want the heavy? Metallica brings the heavy." Like every time.
That's
like
a pretty specific thing. I can't say I've ever done that, but
there are some of those things. There are some like Metallica live recording stuff that like I think that James says it every time, but it's just this one live recording that I've heard a million times, and like there's a couple other artists that I do the same thing, like, but
that's awesome.
That was a terrible metal voice. I feel really stupid about.
Well, it's not like you're the lead singer of a band and you've been on stage.
That's why I'm embarrassed.
Yeah, you just tell the jokes. You're the joke guy.
I'm the joke guy.
I loved that. I do think that was the heaviest song on the album.
But the chorus is so sing-songy.
It's not, though. It's not sing-songy.
Do-do-do. Do-do-do-do.
Yeah.
Do-do-do.
That weird patriotic guitar intro thing, I will say it reminds me very, very much of something from one of the Twisted Metal games. Like, I've gone back.
Oh,
and
no.
Tried to find...
The moment you said that, I was like, I know exactly what you're talking about. I could go get the disc right now and we could play it, and you'd be like, oh my God, that's the exact same thing.
We'll be right back.
Okay, we're back. We got, I got a Mountain Dew. Hey, Chris moved. You're there.
I hope it's not awful.
We almost had live video for like half a second.
Dude, you stopped on the most, you looked like an evil villain for a second. There you go. This is way funnier than it should be. Okay. Oh, do we want to, let's just keep going?
Yes.
Yeah.
We're only 26.
I really hate that you weren't paying attention to the heaviest part of that song.
Oh, I heard it. I didn't agree that it was the heaviest part. I mean, I don't know. I guess I did, but it wasn't. I don't know. It wasn't as good as Lorna Shore.
Well, pretty soon. I mean, that's track 8 is Lorna Shore. So I guess you're right.
All right. Twisting, turning through the never.
Yep.
Three, you ready?
Mm-hmm.
3, 2, 1. Oh, what a weird way to have it come in. I love that.
Yeah, it's so good.
Yes.
See, and then it feels balanced for a second, and in like 10 seconds, I won't feel it balanced again. No, it still is.
I think that there's just an additional guitar track over there.
It sounds great. It's balanced.
It does sound great.
I love it. Big reverb on the snare.
Oh, it's badass. It is cool.
We haven't had... It's not on every snare hit. It's just on a couple, but there's big reverb.
Double bass, kind of. Oh, that's cool.
It is.
That is cool. It is. You're absolutely right. That snare has some crazy reverb on it.
Not every
hit, though. At times.
Mix automation, kids.
Those background vocals sound like they're like way farther away, like they were standing farther from the mic.
I didn't catch that.
That's the first time I've ever noticed that flanging vocal part there. I've never noticed that before when I've listened to this before. Guitar right in the middle. Yep.
The guitar tone is not the same throughout the whole record, the rhythm guitar tone.
This might be my favorite song on the album.
Really?
Yeah.
I could see that.
I mean, I really like... I don't know. Oh, it's kind of...
I don't think I heard that before.
That little rise in there?
Yeah.
Ooh, dude, I love these riffs. Is it just me, or is there more like southern to this? Like southern bluesy rock?
Yeah, it's like rock and roll-y kind of thing.
Yeah.
That's something that leads into low, too. That happens in the later album.
Yeah. Those are extreme left and extreme right. This is so cool.
Yeah.
Ah. Oh, whoa, that's cool. They got me again.
But that riff is very, very similar to the main riff from Master Puppets.
Is it? It's just very repeating. It's just but the whole time.
Which one are you doing? We're right there.
Oh, I was doing this, but you're right.
That sounded just like Puppets. Yeah,
you're right, totally. But the interesting thing about that is Master of Puppets feels more, so much more technical.
Oh, because it's 1,000 times faster.
Well, and this just, yeah, but also like this just feels like it was very repetitive with the riffs, but like it made sense though. But I have to, like there's just something inherently in you that like wants to lean forward while that's happening. Like it's just like it draws you in so much because you're waiting for the resolution, you know. It's such a weird, strange, offbeat thing, and it's just like so gratifying when it's done, you know. It's similar to the Sad But True thing with that long pause. Like it's so good.
They hit you with like 5 pauses in this one.
Yeah. That is such good songwriting. I really like that song. And I would definitely say that would be one of the songs that I would probably skip when I was listening to this way back in the day. I just don't think that song would have grabbed my attention as much. But
I've been very surprised at your willingness to listen to thrashy stuff.
Yeah.
I did not expect that.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. Maybe it's just because like I had to force myself to get into that when we were listening to those other albums, and the stuff that I appreciated the most and liked, I think, the more was the faster stuff.
I know,
and everything.
That's what I was super surprised by, that
with the exception of my favorite Metallica song that we'd listened to up to this point was
the shortest straw.
Yeah, right, the track before Harvester of Sorrow.
Oh,
shortest
I
straw
you, I thought you were gonna say the one that I just said.
For Whom the Bell Tolls?
Yes, For Whom the Bell Tolls.
Oh.
I said it, and then it I said it. You when
you
guys
did say
watching,
it. I heard
and
it.
Then it just went whoop. And
yeah.
Was gone.
No, I
love that
said
song.
That one. I did like that song, but no, I didn't. I wouldn't say that. No, Shortest Straw was my favorite one.
Shortest Straw rips.
Shortest Straw was really good. I liked that. And the cool thing about this was it was sort of like a mid. It was like halfway between Enter Sandman.
Are
and,
you saying that Sad But or but not Sad But True? Shortest Straw is slow.
No, it's slower than this. Wasn't it?
It might, maybe parts of it feel better to you.
I can see that argument.
I guess that wasn't my
but
point.
The chorus.
My point wasn't going to be that though. My point was
the chorus is slow, but the chorus is Master Puppets. Now that we're talking about it, and I'm mixing all these records together,
yeah.
The chorus from Shortest Straw is very similar to the chorus from Master Puppets.
I've only heard Shortest Straw like once or twice. Once editing the video and once
that's
listening.
Fair. That's an interesting point.
But
same guys wrote the songs. I mean, you do that kind of thing, right?
Well, there have been there have been many moments while we've listened to the first two albums where I got like riffs from this album, like the Don't Tread on Me or something. And I was like, that sounds like something that a Metallica riff that I was familiar with. And I wouldn't have known anything other than the songs that were on this album. You know what I mean?
And you said, because I watched this in whatever video we said it in, I watched it at home, and you mentioned, do you think that Metallica was like trying to reference themselves? And like, I as someone who writes metal music, I would never think to do that, but I notice all the time that I like have to stop myself from playing the same riff in a different song, because like it's just what your brain does. It's like, oh, my brain and my fingers kind of do this, so I guess that's what I do.
Well, and the
John Fogerty.
I really like that though, and I do think that was the heaviest song we've heard on this album.
See, your definition of heavy,
yeah,
is so
been different than
it
what we've
moves all over the place. But anyway,
maybe it's just a guitar tone thing. I don't know. Are you ready to move on, Chris?
Yes.
All right. Nothing Else Matters, baby. Ready?
Yeah.
That wasn't a very enthusiastic. Yeah. Three.
I know the song well enough.
Okay. 3, 2, 1. The first thing everyone learns how to play on the guitar, because it's open chords, this part, right?
I guess.
Yeah,
Fade to Black was number one for me.
Fade to Black was number one. Oh, the first song you learned?
When I was playing guitar, yeah.
Oh, this was the first song for me, because you don't have to put your hand anywhere. You can put it in your pocket and play this part. Right? Like, this is tuned to D, but it's just...
Don't do it.
It's. I mean, this isn't tune. It's not in tune. Tune.
Would you please
but
stop?
If you imagine.
We don't. Write the comments. I already can see them in my head.
They've lost it.
Then I did that over this part of this song. Yes.
You should just take all the music out of this and replace it with you.
Shh, the kick drum's back. Because right away, this is definitely the most singy thing we've heard him do. Completely clean vocals. Complete clean. I mean, we did get a little bit on the Unforgiven, but not as much as this.
Yeah, okay.
The only thing it said in the booklet about like credits and stuff was that there was orchestration on Nothing Else Matters. That's the only additional sort of like credit or musical credit that was given.
The lead guitar is on the left.
Yes.
It's weird. Metallica.
Trust I see. That was because they were adding more later in the second half of the verse. Every day for us,
something new. Those guitars came in so smoothly. It was very nice.
And that's a clean electric guitar. Or is it acoustic?
There's so much going on.
There you can hear the strings off to the far side.
Ooh. Floor tom is like gigantic.
I thought I heard a shaker in there for a little bit, but I don't think we've ever heard any aux percussion in any Metallica
thing. We were talking about tambourine.
Tambourine, but I don't know if that was a tambourine though.
Yeah.
I think it was a cymbal. I mean, this certainly screams for a shaker.
It does.
And there is a tambourine when he's hitting the cymbal or the snare.
Yeah. Good time. Yep.
Yep. Oh, this is so epic, this part.
There's that kick drum that's like 10 miles tall.
This is very Eagles.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Hotel California?
Yes, sort of.
That's the only Eagles song I know.
Good job.
I'm proud of that. I don't care about the Eagles. Number one selling song of all time, Eagles Greatest Hits. The highest selling CD of all time, Eagles Greatest Hits.
Because it all rips.
I guess. I've only heard this song. Or I've only heard California. What the hell? It's Hotel California. Right? Because that song's like the length of a whole CD anyway.
Thriller's the best-selling album of all time.
I said CD. The best-selling, the highest-selling CD of all time is the Eagles' Greatest Hits. Is there brass in there too?
Yeah.
Yeah, there's brass in there for sure.
There was some here.
Yeah.
Right. More there.
It has a very plodding feel to it. Very behind the beat, you know? Dude, what a vocal performance by him. A dude that can barely sing at all, singing this fantastic song.
Yeah.
Kick sounds so different in this song.
It sounds really good, I think.
It does sound really good.
Yeah.
They get away with it less.
Well, they can have more low frequencies in it because there was no crunchy guitars.
Yeah. So much layers.
Yeah. And he's singing so softly, which is not an easy thing to do.
Metallica. This is so Eagles, now that I think about that and say that. That feedback stuff that's in there, are those just single notes being held?
They're harmonies, but like, it was done with a pedal, or was it done with just a bunch of layers?
Yeah, I don't know. It's really done really well.
Probably that same pedal.
Is this a fade out?
It is.
It's still going.
It is the best-selling greatest hits album of all time.
Okay, thank you for fact-checking me there. Checking me there.
It seemed like such a crazy thing to have be true.
We run a fact-free. That was actually the senior song. I'm sorry. That one and
that
the Unforgiven are the same song. To
I think that's gorgeous.
It is gorgeous.
It is a gorgeous song. And I am so impressed with his vocals on that after we've heard everything that's come up to this point.
Yeah.
He definitely did some work on his ability to sing between 88 and 91, like hardcore.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, that was like...
He either already could and refused to, or just chose not to before and is now, or he did some work to
and
that,
that's
out
what
how
I would guess. Because he's in a thrash metal band, and if he's saying the thrash metal dudes, they get real pissed at him. But here, he was like, I might as well do...
They did. And boy, did they. Yeah, exactly.
I'm not saying it was wrong, but, you know, history will look back and see who was right in that scenario.
Well.
But, I'm so impressed with that. I think you might be right, Chris, that, like, he probably could sing really well before. Did he sing in church and stuff when he was younger, I wonder?
He played piano pretty young. I don't know. I didn't read anything about him singing.
I just know that's true for a lot of musicians. Like, they played some sort of music in church, and then they, you know, probably went away from the church or whatever. But that was probably where their musical thing started.
The orchestral parts of that song were done by Michael Kamen, who was the guy that basically put together the whole S&M.
I was going to say, is this the genesis for S&M then?
Absolutely, yeah.
Because did they record S&M after this album?
Yeah, S&M was like 2000, so it was like 10 years later.
Oh, so not right after this.
Not yeah.
Right.
Oh, so do they have strings on their other albums then? I've never heard Load and Reload, Chris.
I
have Load right here.
I think that there's probably at least one, maybe two instances of strings on Load and Reload. I have to go back and listen to it, but they're not without.
That's so cool. That I just love that they did that S&M thing.
It's really great, man. It's so good.
Yeah, I really love that. Because they put orchestra with all the songs, right?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah,
there's Enter Sandman with orchestra and all
it's
this.
It's called S&M for Symphony and
Metallica.
Metallica.
I knew that.
Yeah.
Well, I didn't think it was sadomasochistic, whatever. But,
they have two songs that are specifically written for that album.
Really?
There are no... Yeah.
Are there studio versions of it? Or
no, it's just that performance.
Because that's the reason
No Leaf Clover and Minus Human are both S&M.
Oh, I've heard of No Leaf Clover.
And what was the other one?
Minus Human.
Okay. I mean, No Leaf Clover, like...
Well, is it obvious that that one had orchestra written for it?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah? That's awesome. But the reason I've never really looked into S&M is because it's just a live performance, you know?
It's the best-sounding live performance you'll ever put in your head.
It is.
Yeah.
And it was not... It's not like a live performance. They put some mics up. Like, it was meant to be an album, and the... Like, so it is... As far as I remember, because also I have not listened to that in forever, but it is listenable, and most
it is.
Oh, I'm sure it
most
is.
Most live recordings are not.
I agree.
Most live performances aren't.
Disagree.
I don't know.
I think the ultimate litmus test for whether or not a live performance or a live recording is ultimately listenable is whether or not you can listen to it in the car. Like, if you've got
that's a good thought.
If you got your set to random, and then it's like a song, and then a live thing, and it's like song changes, crowd, skip.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, right, name one example of that you would actually stay on.
Yeah. The only time I would listen to a live album is if I wanted to listen to the live album and I put it on intentionally.
And it would be, and if it were
and
for
I've only,
me, it would be to be like, I just want to know if these guys are actually any good.
Oh.
That would be like the only reason I would do that is just to like judge the musicianship.
Oh, I guess. I have
the live Binge and Purge DVD that came out for this tour, and it sounds pretty good. There's actually the versions, the way they play a lot of the songs on that album, on that live show is like, oh, this is I prefer this version over what was in the album originally. Huh. But it is still one where it's like, it comes on in the car and it's like, I know exactly what song and what album it's from immediately just by the crowd noise, but I'm not listening to while I'm driving.
So should we just move on?
Yeah.
Okay, so, oh, Of Wolf and Man.
This is one of my favorites.
I was just going to say, I think this is my least favorite.
I think this is one of my more favorite ones,
too. This is, okay. Oh, well, maybe I'll really love it. Okay, are you ready, Chris?
Yep.
3, 2, 1. Oh, you have done stuff like this in your bands at the off.
Yeah.
Oh, that's so cool.
I love it.
Oh, back to the never. Right. Oh, yeah. Right. Or back to the
back to the front.
Back to yes.
It is kind of.
Oh yeah. Yeah. Totally.
This overheads are so thin. So good.
Is this song just straight up about becoming a werewolf?
Maybe.
It probably isn't. It's probably about, like, I'm sure it has a deeper meaning than that.
It's not much deeper than that. It's about self-exploration.
It sounds pretty deep to me. Person that's never self-explored. There's not a lot of depth to this well. What you see is what you get. And there's a lot that you can see. So cool. I think this song is...
The live version of this.
Is that lyric Shape Shift? Not that one.
No, I think it was. That's what I heard.
I've heard this song a million times.
Back to the meaning.
Yeah, back to the, like, it's not even that, like, well
no.
hidden.
Yeah,
like,
not at all. This is much more straightforward song, especially coming after Nothing Else Matters. Is that a reverse, or do you think he was just going, it sounds reversed.
But, like, underneath, it's kind of weird.
Earth's gift. Dude, this, like, single kick hit there while the riff is going is just so... Ooh. They changed the guitar riff to just dun 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 dun. Are there wolf howls in this song somewhere?
No.
Is that a guitar that...
Yeah.
Oh, that's... Yeah.
I feel a change.
Yeah.
Back to a better day.
How could you do this? And unless you're a comedy band. What the hell are they doing?
I feel the change.
It's cool, though. I mean, I'm not going to say it's not, because it is cool. It's a little cringy. I mean, it's a lot cringy, but who cares?
Is that why I don't like Megadeth?
I wish it was about vampires instead, but...
Well, there's still time.
That's true. What do we got left?
Well, I just meant in
72 seasons.
Demo.
We'll have a whole vampire... Several Sug songs in a row.
No fade out there.
No fade out. That's. I think I like the song more than I remember, but I just remember being like embarrassed listening to that. Like, that's.
I like.
It's really tough to deal with talking in songs. When you brought that up over on To Live Is To Die, for that particular song, I was like, well, I'll give it a pass for this song for what it is, but normally I couldn't agree with you more. You don't talk in songs. There's a song in the new Death Cab album from that I did in our top 12 last, you know, whenever, that I was like, this song is all talking
you
and
said
it's
that.
Garbage.
Yeah, get rid of that track.
I
don't want to make you feel bad because I know you've done that on some of the Primal stuff, especially on that first
and
album.
And I was just, well, whatever, but I don't care.
No, I know.
I was thinking about the beginning of Omerta by Lamb of God. I think that is like so incredibly heavy.
Well, it depends how it's done.
It does, in the middle.
It depends how it's done.
But the cool thing about that song, I think, is that the whole, maybe it's not the whole chorus, I know, but like the hook that makes us a chorus is just those two notes. The words change once. I've heard that song a million times, and this is the first time that I realized that it was
shape shift.
And then whatever the second
move swift.
Oh, mm-hmm. Is it? Oh yep. Boy.
And then the third time it's cringy rhyming on this
record.
Yes. No,
what is it though? It's shape shift. What else do the wind? Move swift. Earth's gift.
Earth's
is the
gift.
Next one. deep breaths.
There was another song on this record, I can't remember which one it was now, but like the rhyming, and like he saves it in the last line of the verse because he does a not rhyme and it works, but like I was actually listening to the lyrics this time and I'm like, wow, that is actually just like not really great lyric writing.
Well, the funny thing about this is I was paying attention to the lyrics a lot in this song too, and it's funny that we all were, kind of, because it is, you're like, is this song about a werewolf?
It totally
like,
is.
Like, is this a song about wolves? You're going to sing about that? And I was like, eh.
That's awesome. It's metal, though.
It is kind of cool, though. I mean, it's no different than singing about dragons and battles and whatever and mm-hmm. krakens and stuff. So, like, it is absolutely cool. But it is also something that's just like, you know, we were all paying attention to it, so it was
on a pop rock.
But I mean, if you want to compare,
it is kind of
If you want to compare it to like their other fantastical lyrical elements, like this versus the thing that should not be, is like no contest. That song
is the things that should not be supposed to be fantastical.
I mean, I think it's supposed to be like a beast that lives at the bottom of the sea, or like the Kraken or something.
Oh, you know? I thought it was like an introspective one.
It might be. I mean, you know,
why not both? Both? Why not both?
But I know that they do. I mean, they, you know, the Call of Cthulhu, like they definitely go into that realm every once in a while.
Yeah, but that ain't got no words on it.
I understand. Creeping Death, though. Creeping Death is about Passover. But like that's the most metal thing in the world, is to take a song about Passover and make it just about the perspective of the death that takes everybody. Like that's
Creeping Death just sounds so freaking cool.
And
it is that song.
I didn't mention it. And it even says like on here that Creeping Death Records or whatever was something that the songs were licensed to initially. I noticed that. But man, Creeping Death is just
what a great.
That's got to be one of the most metal things ever put together.
Just the
Creeping
best two
Death.
Words.
they do that. Metallica. I mean, that's them, right? Like, they're the ones deciding those things, right?
Oh, yeah.
That's cool. They're good at that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
Okay, moving on to track 10, The God That Failed.
Mm-hmm.
You ready, Chris?
Do you want to know what this is about before we listen to it?
Yeah, sure.
It's really interesting. Both of his parents were, like, super hardcore, like, evangelical Christian Science people who would, you know, were anti-medicine, and they were just like, you know, pray instead of go to the hospital.
Mm-hmm.
And his mom died of cancer because of that attitude that she had.
Mm-hmm.
And this song is about that fact.
Okay.
Which I think is really cool.
Totally see that. All right. Let's give it a listen with the context. Ready?
Yeah.
3, 2, 1. Yes, I forgot this. Yes. Yes.
That bass tone is just so good.
It is good. Oh, yeah. Like you said, Chris, that plodding through sludge feeling.
Yes.
And you know why it has that feeling? Because everything is played slightly behind the beat.
Interesting. That's interesting. Space.
That's the difference between jazz music and blues music. Not the jazz music can't.
The guitars. Pride you took, pride you feel, pride that you feel when you did.
There's like a stereo effect to his vocal here.
Yeah, like a delay thing. Best use of the stereo field so far.
Yeah.
Guitars are even, that call and response thing in the like it's even. Love it.
You know, how many songs the heavy, the riff, the heavy, the root of the riff, the low note, is on the one and not the two and the four? You know what I mean? Ba-da-da, ba-da-da, you know, rather than ba-da-da, ba-da-da, which, it, you know, I mean, that's not uncommon, but like, it just has a different feel when it is that. It makes you feel like you're falling forward, waiting for it, you know?
Yeah, right.
You know? Really good harmonies here, too. Dude, those lyrics, too. Very cool. What a lead into the solo. Just as the lead in. This could be a Five Finger Death Punch song.
I think you killed him.
At least it's on this record and not like one of the good ones.
For the record, I do not hate Five Finger Death Punch. I don't really like much of their stuff, but I think they have some really, really awesome riffs, especially on their first album. And I do really like their singer, Ivan Moody, but I think his two previous bands were way cooler than...
What's that thing?
Dude, some of these lyrics are just, like, iconic. You know, just... It's... Maybe it's because it's so simple. And that jump up here in the chorus... You know? I mean, it's just good songwriting, but... Shaker.
Yep.
Yep, there it is.
Big, close mic. Pretty dry.
And a Shaker, the Shaker is in not the slow song, but in one of these more straightforward songs.
Yeah, mid-tempo, yeah.
Ooh. Love it. I love it when a band can... A little western-y, spaghetti western ending there. That's cool.
There's a lot of load and reload in that song.
That's awesome.
I guess I kind of do remember that from those records.
I loved that. I thought that was great. Way better than I thought it was going to be. The moment it started and it's that da-da-dum, da-da-dum. It's like, oh my God, this is so awesome. It's epic, right? It's
right. Yeah. I can't not think of like the arena setting when this was happening, which was probably done on purpose that like fast music doesn't work in arenas.
I just, when we were listening to that, I was thinking, every heavy band that I listen to is like, this has to be like one of their most influential things, right? I mean,
mostly.
When I was listening to that guitar solo, I was like, this is every metal band that I listen to is probably the way they are because of Metallica.
That's
I know that, but like it just I was just listening, I was like, this none of that stuff would be there without this.
It's fun to have that realization.
Yeah.
I'm surprised that Patrick okay, Chris, you go.
Well, because I'm not a Beatles fan at all. I've heard a handful of Beatles songs, mostly the hits. And so that's just their existence in my musical world. But every once in a while, I'll listen to something that's, you know, just like I listened to the White Album once, for example. And suddenly I heard a little diddly guitar bit that started a song that was like, oh, that is exactly the same as the beginning of a Blue October song. And it's like you go back and you start to hear the influences in reverse, which is just such a neat thing.
Huh. Yeah. The Beatles, really? That weirds me out. I know it's cool not to like them now, but.
Well, I never liked them, so I was cool the whole time.
Yeah, I know that you didn't. I remember having this argument like
I don't
15
know,
years ago.
Like Chris Parker, I only know the certain Beatles songs, but I will tell you the decision to put his stupid footsteps or whatever the shit that was when they were recording that dumb bird song on the far side, when it's so
is that
horrific.
On one of the records that's just mixed left, center, right though?
I don't care what it was. It's stupid. It's stupid.
I'd listen to
the mono Beatles records before I'd listen to their stupid stereo. But the same can be said for one of my favorite artists, Nancy Sinatra too. So you know, I'll be a little hypocritical.
I could go on a whole different thing. I haven't. Whatever. Anyway, I'm surprised that Patrick did not freak out about the way that the line, the God that failed, was delivered in that, because you have picked me apart so often.
Oh, because he tried to fit too many words in
he did.
In a
I'm
still
surprised that you
the
weren't like,
God failed!
Especially the one in the first chorus. The first time it happens, it's like, if I went and did something like that, like if I was recording myself doing vocals,
I would be like,
and I did that, like I would hear Patrick in my head, and like part of me would just say,
interesting. But it's really funny.
You know, it's funny you say that too, because one of the other things I noticed on this song, and I was going to save it for if we discuss at the end, but we can just do it now. But I have to give James credit, because I don't know how much, like, I'm sure there was a lot more like post editing and post processing on this album than probably on previous Metallica albums. But there was one time in that song, the one we just listened to, and one time before this where I heard him doing double takes, and it was so far off, it was distracting to me. Like the timing of his takes.
Oh, really?
Yeah, that's only happened twice. Once in this song, and it was when he did the God that failed,
the first one.
The tumbly part. Yeah, yeah. It was the
was
first time.
Was it a double that was bothering? Maybe it was just a double.
Well, I don't know. I'm not sure, but I noticed that specifically, which is why I'm glad you bring that up and remind me of that. But then one other time earlier on the album, I noticed he was doing doubles, and his transient was not even close. And it sounded like, I cannot stand that. I hate that, because I've spent countless hours moving vocal tracks to line up, and I know I'm not the greatest audio engineer in the world. If I can do it, whoever's doing Metallica can move his stupid vocals around so that they line up. You know,
what is this done digitally?
That's a good point. I know, I understand the technology and all that stuff. That's why I want to point it out. Like, I think James did a fantastic job doing his overdubs.
I was having a discussion about that exact thing, making sure that your doubles are like exactly. And now
it's the reason, just real quick before I forget it, it's the reason I can't listen to The Sounds, one of my favorite bands of all time. I cannot listen to their first album because it is atrociously bad in every song. And her vocals are doubled the entire time. And it's their first album, so they were young, and I give them credit for that. But like, I can't listen to that album because it's so bad.
It's an interesting point you bring up, because I'm reading here earlier in the wiki, it says Bob Rock insisted they record as many takes as needed to get the sound they wanted. This album was remixed 3 times and cost $1 million.
Isn't that crazy to think about a record costing $1 million to make?
They made it back a lot.
Well, right.
Yeah, of course.
But what if it would have tanked, you know?
And I mean, and maybe that was part of the deal, was like coming off of Justice. Like, I just, like the foreshadowing, I understand that. But like, this is a different band.
Yeah, way better band.
Then what did you say?
Oh
then,
my god!
Then
they're
three previous
to do
albums.
Hot takes.
No, it's not a hot take. This is so obviously better than anything they've done.
No,
I wouldn't say
it's
that.
It's not.
It's different.
From a production standpoint.
Oh yeah, yes.
Yeah,
it's just different. Yeah, I'm kidding. But like,
Patrick hates Heart.
Heart?
Art.
Oh, I was gonna say I like Heart.
I'm actually kind of surprised by that too.
Their first few albums are pretty unlistenable. They're like folky, weird stuff. But once they get a little,
to Barrick,
get to like Magic Man,
Magic Man.
Magic Man, it's so good.
Oh my god, it's fantastic! The keyboard that solo that goes song. For like 10 minutes. Yes, please.
I love that song.
Oh, dude, yes, I love Magic Man. But yeah, Dreamboat Annie. Anything off Dreamboat Annie. But anyway, yeah. I don't remember what we were talking about, so we can just go on to the next song. Next song we have is My Friend of Misery, the longest song on the album, clocking in at 6:49.
$1 million.
It's pretty crazy.
In 1991.
Yeah, don't you think
In 1991.
But don't you think, you were saying earlier about how like Rihanna or whatever made an, like to pay all those people, it's got to take $1 million.
Maybe now.
You know what I mean? Like,
but this wasn't like that. This is a,
no,
this
no,
is
you're
like
right.
Sort of,
yeah.
A, I mean, they're a band. I mean, this is obviously like super produced.
But this was this. You have to remember too. Also, this was like the height of the music industry in terms of
yes.
people buying,
yes.
and also record yes. labels and all this stuff. So like, the whole music industry was way different back then.
But
they said they sold 31 million copies of physical media of this album.
It's unbelievable.
I got two of them right here.
Yep, there they are.
Anyway,
all right, My Friend of Misery. You ready, Chris?
Yes,
cool. I have no idea what this song sounds like. I can't think of it in my head at all. 3, 2, 1.
Another bass intro.
Yeah. Very Godsmack of them. Yes.
Different guitar tone again. Different rhythm guitar tone.
It sounds like Tool, right? With the bass like that?
Oh, it kind of does.
I mean, I don't know anything about Tool.
But I can see where you're coming from.
Yeah. Just the fact that the bass is moving and the guitars really aren't as much. Dude, very rarely are the guitars doing something so different like this. You know, the guitar on the right is just ringing out, you know, where the guitar on the left is playing the riff. And then I assume it'll come in and they'll... I can't kind of remember what's happening, but... Hold on, I'm going to pause it. Have you been listening to it the whole time?
No, when you said, are you ready? I said yes, and then I started talking. I was going to say a thing, and right when I started talking, I clicked the X for Streamlabs, and it just closed the whole thing.
Oh,
so let's go back then.
Yeah, let's just listen to
over.
The whole thing.
What I was going to say about this song, that I take back what I said earlier, because I think this is probably my favorite song on the album, and I had, after my dad moved out, he left these speakers behind that they were probably like 4 foot tall, huge Marantz speakers with like these 12 inch subs in the bottom. And I played the beginning of this song as loud as I could until stuff fell off of the walls. And it was awesome.
A few things that I mentioned that I was waiting for you to comment on. We'll start the song and we'll talk about it a little bit then.
Okay.
So you ready to start the song then?
Yep.
Okay. 3, 2, 1. Okay, you still there?
So much. Yeah.
Yeah.
So,
another bass intro.
Yes. So, I'm gonna keep that last stuff in. I'm not editing that out.
Oh, you're not editing that out. Wow. I was just gonna try to copy it.
I could, I guess, but no. One of the things I said, Chris, was this Tool. This reminded me of Tool.
Yep.
Though I don't know much Tool, but then I switched my thought and I was like, this is way more Chevelle.
Oh yeah. Ooh, that's interesting.
Right.
Because Chevelle is very cool a lot, too.
Also, when we got to the chorus, Chris and I both agree. We were like, this just does not sound like a Metallica chorus.
Or like a Metallica riff.
Like a Metallica riff, yeah.
Mm.
This does. This is all Metallica.
Yeah. Very generous of them to let Jason Newsted play for a while.
He does, like, 5 minutes of this live, where he just plays this, and then it just gets more and more complex, and then they start the song.
Oh, that's cool.
Another one where it sounds like it starts on the second line.
Yep. awesome. That is such an awesome observation. Yes.
I thought that for like
it absolutely
since
does.
I was a little kid.
Oh, that's so weird.
You.
There's the acoustic guitar.
Yeah, that's just. Why?
Yeah, it's weird.
It's cool. It's
yeah,
super
I like
cool.
It.
I would have never thought.
Okay, this is so far away.
Okay, this note. Yeah, that world. Like there was like vibrato in there that we've never heard
is
before.
Is that some sort of like? Is that
auto-tune?
Is it auto-tune?
I don't think so. This is way before Eiffel 65 perfected that technique.
Dude, I actually own that album.
I still have it and listen to it frequently. It's called Europop and it's fantastic. They've actually released four albums since then. They're from France, obviously. But they're awesome. Their other albums are all in French. But they do have a double copy of their second album called Transmission. That one disc is in English. All the songs in English. One disc is the second disc is all in French. Good luck. Actually, it's called Contact. Good luck trying to find that son of a bitch somewhere to purchase for less than $50. I'm gonna have to edit myself.
That vocal in there.
Oh, all right, Metallica.
Yeah, yeah.
So I got excited about Eiffel 65 for a second. Also in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. I just made that up. Bloodhound Gang. This is like Avenged Sevenfold, right? Something like that. I don't know who they are. I don't really know any of their songs.
Not Metallica.
Is this more like Load and Reload then?
Not really.
Because it is very different.
Mm-hmm.
We'll see what the bridge does here.
There is some load in this part. Torn Within, Outlaw Torn, very much so. What was that?
Like a shaking, some sort
there
of like
a... There was almost like chimes.
Yeah. I love this though, how quiet it is. Is your mind blown now, Chris? I'm just like, what is this?
It is weird. Those weird bends on the guitar.
They don't usually meander like this.
Well, on Orion.
Is that a B bender? Somebody tell me if that's a B bender.
Mm. Whoa.
But they've been using that harmonized.
Yeah, that is a pedal, right?
Sounds like one to me. I guess I don't know. Yeah, that's some like synthesizer, harmonizer pedal. Maybe that's what it was in those other spots where we mentioned it too.
Yeah.
It sets a more computer sound on this one.
Did this feel like when Van Halen released Jump? Or is that a bad analogy?
I have no idea.
Or when ZZ Top released Eliminator?
Maybe that's a better example. Patrick's favorite ZZ Top record.
Oh no, Mascalero from 2006.
Alligator, alligator.
Good stuff. Talk about a record with bass. Mescalero by ZZ Top. Weird. There's no way this song don't fade out, right?
I don't know. New super heavy riff.
Yep. Whoa. Wow. It does not feel like we're listening to Metallica anymore.
Now I lay me down to sleep.
It didn't fade out.
You know, it's interesting. You mentioned Orion.
Yeah.
This was originally going to be an instrumental song.
I was wondering if that wasn't going to be that. Oh. It sounded like instrumental Metallica to me.
Yeah, I just learned that earlier, and I...
Well, thank you, Metallica.
Now, it's like...
Thank you for putting words to your stupid instrumental song.
That's what it sounds
wrong.
Like.
That's awesome. That was a strange song, though. Even, like, my dumb idiot self could tell. Like, that was weird.
There were parts of it that I liked.
Yeah.
But most of it...
And Newstead wrote that opening bass business, like that main riff.
That's pretty awesome. That's cool. I don't know. I didn't care for that song as much.
No.
I don't think.
I don't remember. I don't
remember that
I
one.
I don't hardly remember that one at all. There are parts, I guess, like the chorus part. Like, oh, yeah.
It was very meandering.
Yeah.
Well,
there was that part right before the solo, but after the lyrics where it was just kind of like just working its way through.
Yeah.
Nothing's changing much. Real slow build up. They don't usually waste time. That's the thing.
Well,
I wouldn't go so far as to say it felt like a waste of time. But they
what
don't.
The hell are you
like
talking about, dude?
Is going to fight you so what? Hard on this.
Oh my God! Listen to Master
what?
Of Puppets or any of their
I'm
songs
with
that's
you, Chris.
Over 7 minutes long. They feel the need to write the first half of a song, and then they'll have four different guitar solo sections, and then they'll finish the song a little bit, or they won't. They'll just keep doing guitar solos. Like Metallica doesn't.
Well, it
waste
depends
time
on whether or not you think guitar solos count as wasted time.
It's not wasted time, but why do you need four separate ones in the same song?
Why not? Why do you have three verses in a song?
Because you like playing guitar, damn it.
You like singing, damn it.
Yeah, that's fine, but spread them out. Give me something that I enjoy listening to rather than just four guitar
that's
solos.
That's such
a
funny... It is funny, though. I mean, I've been thinking of this now that we've been on guitar solo watch for the last few weeks.
Yeah.
But, like, isn't that funny that, like... you can listen to people sing forever. I mean, it's not funny because it's human voice and everybody has one and blah, 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 blah.
Right.
But like, right? You don't ever say that. Jeez, I just wish the singing had stopped so I could hear it. So I could, like, hear a guitar solo.
Yeah.
Like, what a good, like.
You know, I definitely want to say, though, like, I have noticed the guitar solos on this album are not the same as the guitar solos. Every one of them is like wah all over the place.
There is a lot of wah.
And to
there
me...
There's definitely a point where he discovered the wah and never looked back.
Well, there's a lot of wah even on Ride the Lightning. To me... Well, maybe not as much, but there is definitely some, because that was where the Godsmack joke started. Because to me, when I hear wah guitar, I think of Godsmack. And that's where the joke comes from. But like, to me, I like the solos way more when it's not the wah fest.
I think that there's a lot of people on the internet that would agree with you on
that. So to me, like, I am missing the guitar solos of... I am. Now, I will say, I do appreciate this album, that we have not, I don't think yet, had a song that felt like there were multiple guitar solo sections in a row. Well, this one, but that it didn't feel like that to me because a lot of it just felt like outro. Like, the outro of this song was, like, the last 2 minutes.
Oh, I...
So, like, they're just... You can get... The feeling of the song didn't change. It just kept going and going and going. And like I noticed at the end of the song there was a part where Kirk was doing a lead and he would lead for like a measure and then stop. And James did a little bit of singing and then Kirk would lead for a little bit and then stop. And James would do a little bit of singing. And that's the first time I think we've heard something like that where they're like back and forth between the vocals and the lead. Like that was kind of neat. I don't know if I would say that I like loved that part or anything, but like, I don't know. To me, the wah kind of takes away from it a little bit.
I would not disagree with you because it's a lot.
Yeah,
and
it is.
You get tuned into it and you're like, that's. But like on there are parts like on Sandman where it's used as an effect on the rhythm guitar.
Yep.
And like that's super cool. There's another texture, but
yep,
like,
I agree.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's just too much sometimes, and it just I don't know. Like it to me, it feels like it takes away. But it also, I don't know if maybe I'm basing that because of all the stuff I've heard that's done it because of the sound that they got here and liked so much. You know, I was joking about like Avenged Sevenfold and bands like that I don't really know anything about at all.
Avenged Sevenfold is Metallica a lot, so it's not a strange thing
I've heard that before, but like I just think when I hear Avenged Sevenfold, I think of like Southern metal, like Southern United States metal. I don't know if that's true. That's they're probably from England or somewhere. I have no clue, but
they're not. They're from the US.
I just like think of them having more of like a Southern feel to them, which is what I would think of Pantera too. But I don't really know very much about Pantera at all. But they were from the South, right? They were very much South.
They're from Texas.
Yeah, Southern dudes. Like, in a lot of genres of music, I like stuff that's more like Southern feeling. Like, I really like that, like New Orleans, like Louisiana Bayou, like really like twangy guitar type sounding stuff. None of that is here. But the fact that
here's a hot take.
Yeah,
Texas is more Midwest than South.
Yeah, well.
I just disagree.
There are some people that
Well, because like just in terms of like the vibe, the cultural vibe of the South that you're talking about.
Oh, is it really in Texas?
Stuff,
yeah.
That's not a Texas style.
No, it's not. No, that's much more of a Louisiana, Georgia, South Carolina, North Carolina.
Like, Texas mm-hmm. music is.
But not
music.
Also not Florida either. Yeah, Texas music.
No, we're going to talk about Louisiana music. We should just be talking about goat whore.
I don't know what that is, but my interest is piqued. Goat whore.
Oh, I think I've heard that.
They turned out a great record in 2022. It is fantastic. That's awesome.
Are they an older band or?
They've been around for a long time.
For a while.
But it's like, yeah.
I completely forgot to mention that the first Grammy Award for Metal Album of the Year came into existence because of how good Injustice for All was, and then Jethro Tull won.
Yeah, we mentioned that on a previous video.
We mentioned that
last week. I didn't hear it on the Justice one, so I wasn't
because
sure.
I was going to put my Jethro Tull album on the wall, and I didn't know that story and their history with Metallica.
Oh, that's...
That would have been a real shame that you did that on... You've done that on accident.
I know, I wish I would have done that, but I didn't.
Why is my house on fire?
Yeah, anyway, that was a weird one. But I guess, right, they probably got told that they can't put an instrumental track on this record that's going to sell 30 million copies. And so they put some words on it, and they kind of let them be weird. And they're like, it's the second to last one, so I guess it's okay.
That is the spot where Metallica's been putting there.
It is. There are
that is
songs.
Really interesting to know, yeah.
I'm sure, mm-hmm. I'm sure that that's what the discussion was.
Yeah, I'm sure it probably was. Really strange.
Right, I don't think that it's that great of a song, but that one riff is just like so not Metallica. Mm. It's really weird. I wonder if that was, I don't know who.
Maybe it was Jason Newsted. Maybe he had more writing privileges on that song.
Maybe.
I wonder that too.
Mm-hmm. You know? All right, last track, The Struggle Within. Is this going to be another fast one? I can't remember, but that's what Metallica likes to do. End their album just abruptly with a fast song, thrashy song. All right, you ready, Chris?
Yep.
All right, 3, 2, 1. Oh, okay.
See, again, there's some like Ride the Lightning harmony stuff there.
But
like,
also very.
Is that a concert bass drum?
Could have been. It sounded. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah,
some sort of low timpani.
Head. Yeah.
But it also very patriotic feeling again.
Yeah, kind of.
With the marching.
There's that snare cymbal.
Oh, reaching up for something. Yeah. Okay. Oh,
different guitar tone again? There are like really different guitar tones on all of these.
I don't think they're that different though. I don't know. I'm not noticing it, but
this has some Am I Evil vibes.
I was just thinking there's a lot of In Flames in this.
Ooh.
A lot. Especially with that pre-chorus riff and the chorus riff, which is just holding out chords. Not this part at all, though.
Justice snare drum again.
Whoa. Yeah, this is very In Flames. With those harmonies at the end, the da-da-da-da-da. A lot of vocal parts here. So did the other guys in the band have to do the Struggle Within, the first one?
Jason Newsted did a bunch of those.
He does? Okay, what are we going to do now? Yeah. No wah pedal here. Whoa. Now the wah comes in. Godsmack back. They play this one live? I mean, I know they played all these songs live over time, but I wonder if this is one they still play.
I don't think I've seen this live.
Yeah. Because it feels so close to what you know they probably want to be doing, but not far enough. You know, if they're going to do this, they might as well just play a song, Battery or something, you know what I mean? Not that they're the same, but... Plus, it'd be harder to do the call and response vocal stuff. Hey, they're giving us a little album ending at least here. Oh, okay, maybe not. There's the Black Album by Metallica.
We did it.
And Chris, we have video of you again.
Hot damn.
Now you look stupid in real time.
What I do best.
Oh, nope, it's gone. I like that song.
Yeah,
I like that one. I don't think I liked it the best, but I don't know. I want to hear you talk a little bit about what we just listened to. Everything. How you feel about the album as a whole. Yeah, just how do you feel about it? Because I know you hadn't listened to it for a long time, and you probably had very negative connotation before we got to this. So I'm just really curious what you felt about it.
I don't know if I had super negative connotations about it.
But you certainly bring baggage to this that I didn't. And I don't think Chris did. Just because...
Oh, you mean because the three albums before it were like...
Yeah.
So much better.
I completely disagree with that.
Other records are metal records.
Right.
This is...
This is going to go into the fundamental thing you and I talk about all the time.
I know. I think it's good.
Mm-hmm.
It's good. And I mean, you can't deny it. Like, it sold 32 million copies. And, like, I don't hate listening to it. I like a lot of it. I probably, murder me in the comments for this one, but I probably could have dealt without those last two songs.
Yeah, I could see that, especially that last.
And this is more songs than we've had on a Metallica album so far.
Yep, by several tracks.
And I guess, in a way, I'm sort of surprised because what they were trying to do here, because, like, they knew what was going to happen. However, it's so hard for me to think about...
You think they knew it was going to be big?
They spent $1 million making it.
Well, I know, but I mean... Yeah.
It's so weird to me to think that Justice was so big that they could go do this with that kind of money. Hmm. That part, it's just so much different than it is now.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I don't know. Like, it's good. I really like it. I think it sounds great. Some of the songs are really, really cool. You can hear.
Did you? I guess the thing I kind of wanted from you was: Do you think you liked it more than you thought you were going to?
No, about the same.
About the same. Okay.
And like most of the stuff that, like, some of the things, like the God That Failed, for example, like that is one of those songs that I know decently well. I know what the guitars and lyrics are going to do, but like if you would have told me like. Sing me part of the God That Failed. Like, I did not even know that that was a lyric in that song.
Right.
Because I just never listened to stuff like that. At least this stuff like that. I didn't at that time when I was getting that. I don't know. It's good. Like, of course it's good.
Yeah.
But it's not my favorite by any means. I would take as far as things that I like Death Magnetic and Hardwired, I think, more than
this one.
That's interesting.
I just like, because I like Metallica, I don't being a thrash band.
I think that's a very interesting thing to say. No one's ever said that before.
I do, and I know.
But I'm not here to disagree with you on that either. I've never considered comparing those two to this.
Well, I have a couple older friends, and I'm going to ask them, not like older, but they're older than us, and I think, and they're, especially one of them is a huge Metallica fan, and mm-hmm. I'm kind of worried about him actually like physically harming me after he's heard some of the things that I've said. He like has a Metallica shrine in his basement. Like mm-hmm. he's got the Justice for All plastic like playset thing, and and it's battery powered, and you press a button and the lights change and like a song plays.
Oh, that's
it's
cool.
It's so cool.
Wow.
From Justice Era. Anyway, and I told them once that like I said I think that a couple of like maybe my top 20 favorite Metallica songs are on Death Magnetic, and one of them just gave me the look like, and you know, they're rock guys. They are not really like metal dudes. Sorry, I know Jeff and Brett that you are, but but like I don't know, like I like Metallica playing faster riffs, and there are some on there, but I don't know, I like metal, and I'm
really glad that you like Death Magnetic and Hardwired so much, because I really like those albums a lot, and I just feel like I can't tell anybody that, because it's like if you like anything post Black, you might as well just go dig a hole and bury yourself in it. But I am so completely on board with that.
And you alluded to that earlier, so I knew that this was a safe space where I could say that sort of thing.
Hell yeah.
No, and you knew I'll think that this is by far the best Metallica album. So.
If I wanted to pick a song to play at a baseball stadium, Enter Sandman all day long.
Man, I really hate, so much that has happened to these songs, because they don't deserve it.
Why not? That's the point of writing a song like that, that everyone's supposed to like. Everybody
to hear
it
in the grocery store? Like,
I don't know if I've heard Metallica at the grocery store, have I?
No, and thank God, because the sun would not rise somewhere the next day if that happened.
Certainly when when you go like light bolt, like bowling, black light bowling or whatever, this is going to be one of the songs.
Oh, yeah,
play
for sure.
But
I've been in the grocery store and heard the occasional song that I like that I would never have considered to be popular enough to be at a, you know, grocery store, and you hear it, and you're like, well, that's it. I can't listen to this ever.
Once you reach grocery store level status, it's, you've definitely sold out there.
Yeah, it's bleak.
I don't know. I
think that they were trying to do what they were trying to do.
Yeah.
And I think that they did it very well, and they sort of did it like Metallica. And like, I mean, you cannot argue with the commercial success. And if that was their goal, if they said, if before this happened, if somebody either said, do you guys want to be the biggest rock band in the world? Or they walked up to some label guy or producer person and said, we want to be the biggest rock band in the world. Like, this is what you do.
Mm-hmm.
And like, I don't have any problem with that.
They picked Bob Rock because of how he did. He had just done that Motley Crue song with the drums in the front that sound like an engine or whatever. I can't remember what it's called. Hoffer Teacher, I think, maybe.
That was, and like, not Motley Crue, that's Van Halen.
Oh, dang. Then
so
it's, not
it's,
that.
It's
what the hell song am I thinking of?
Girls, Girls, Girls. Isn't that the only Motley Crue song?
I can't remember, but picked him because of how much what he had done for Motley Crue.
It was Motley
Crue.
And
that was like, that was their decision. And it was like, you're not going to get somebody who just produced Motley Crue as a producer and not have him try to guarantee that you will be on the same level as them from a popularity perspective. So I think it makes sense that they would expect this to do well.
The thing that I don't want it to go overlooked, though, too, is like, imagine if you were 9 when you heard this instead of however old we were. Well, when we were younger, I mean, whatever. Imagine if you heard this album and this was your first heavy album you'd ever heard, and you were like, oh man, I really like Holier Than Thou Are and Don't Tread on Me, you know, and Through the Never, you know, like I really like these faster songs. Like, don't you think that this would be a really great album to get someone into heavier music?
Oh, absolutely. Yes. And that's like
this is a fantastic.
And I think that those kind of albums are really dumped on all the time because people who are already into metal hate them. But I think they're so important for getting people into heavier music. You know, I just want to point that out because people really crap on
I think the commercial success of it is 1,000% warranted.
Yeah, but it's not even the success of it either. I just mean like the way it's made. Like it sounds good, first of all, which is not necessarily something that you could definitively say. It's more of a taste thing with their first three albums. This like objectively sounds professionally done and really good. There's no like, oh, this sounds really good for what it is. No, it's like this sounds good because it is what it is. But the fact that there is still heavier and faster things that are on here is, I think, so important. And like I said, like so many bands that I like are much closer to this than their first three albums. And I consider those bands just as much metal as anything else, yes. You know?
You are
well, that's what I mean about the
Well, I know. That's
what I mean about the commercial success aspect is like you don't sell 40 million copies of something if it's not super accessible.
Right.
And it's like that this is it swings open the gates of this type of music to so many people.
And those things are important culturally. I will not disagree with that because I mean that's absolutely the way that I got into the stuff that I got into. And if I haven't told this story before, and I'll probably tell it again, but like I remember the first time that I heard Pantera. I remember it very, very vividly, and that was like the first time I'd probably heard extreme metal. And we turned it on, and the beginning of Strength Beyond Strength started. Me and one of my best friends who was in a band with me in high school, and we turned it on.
Gremlins?
And we almost immediately turned it off, like, because we were scared because it was so extreme.
Yeah.
But then eventually, like, and then, like, 2 or 3 years later, like, we wore that tape out because it was on a cassette. But I had heard stuff like this, and I'm like, oh, I think I like distortion guitars. Like, I don't need to just listen to Billy Joel. Like, I can listen to stuff, right? Like,
yeah.
And so it's important culturally, but, like, if I say that it's my favorite Metallica record, and it is not, but if I were to say that, the cops would literally stop me outside of your house and take my metal elitist card away.
It's just
and I can't.
It's just so funny what people perceive as being like willing, like what different people perceive as something that can justify some. I don't know if I can word what I'm thinking. Like something that you just said to me. Something that you just said really reminded me of Black Sabbath and how people think of them as like the best metal band of all time.
There are a lot of people that think that.
I know that. But the thing is, do they just think that because they're one of the first metal bands?
I hate
it when people have opinions like that. I hate that. Like, I hate that. And something about what you just said made me think that. And I think it was because you were talking about how people discredit something. It's really hard for me to articulate what I'm thinking.
But that brings up an interesting point. Yeah. Because how many times throughout the listening of these four records that we've done now have we said, like, oh, this sounds just like so much. And, like, we are aware here in the comment section of the linear passage of time in that, yes, that In Flames happened after the Black Album.
I'm glad you phrased it that way.
Right. Right.
But like, so, I mean, there is something, I don't think that warrants merit unto itself that something was the first, but you have to give this stuff credit. Like even the Black Album, for making pop metal.
Yes. That's what I was trying to say.
Because everybody references it and correct. Because they were the first one and they did it either they did it so well or that it was so big, because you could go make arguments that there are better records that are the equivalent to Ride the Lightning, Master Puppets, but for whatever reason, Metallica was the one that was so big. And so like that does say something that it was like so influential and like at least good enough, if not so good, that everybody afterwards copied it.
Yeah.
Because you can go take parts, you can go take probably almost any part of any Metallica song up to this record. And you can go find it in like in anything from, you know, whatever, you can say that Five Finger Death Punch thing that like I can't say out loud completely.
Right.
To like extreme metal stuff.
Yeah.
Like actually real good metal where they play really fast and just basically make pig grunty noises because that's actually what metal is supposed to be. And you can go find stuff that is like Metallica.
Yeah. No, you're right. You're absolutely
because
right.
Because they heard all the same crap that they did when they were 14 as I did.
Yeah, yeah.
Right? Like.
But I just don't think that someone being that's what I was trying to articulate, but I couldn't figure out a way to do it. Like, it's funny what people give bands credit for, and then when they do something important like the Black Album, they don't give them credit that it deserves because it's a different scenario, if that makes sense. Like, this album should be this. But the other thing to keep in mind too is, like, probably like we said, I wouldn't have any problem saying that I'm sure that a majority of people who love this album probably have never heard the first three Metallica albums.
Like, I think there's a lot of people that's
a majority of people who own this, those 34 million copies.
Well, yeah, what's the sales difference between Justice right. and
I think it's, I mean, just based on the numbers alone, it has to be true.
Yes. Right. And so it's just like someone heard this and they didn't feel the need to go backwards. You know what I mean? So, like, then, this is the starting point. And so I just think that that's just as valid for those people as Ride the Lightning is for hardcore thrash people. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Like, I'm not trying to argue. I'm just saying, like, it's interesting what people would consider to be, like, a good thing and a negative influence or something like that. Like, it's hard to articulate what I'm thinking. But anyway, okay.
I was talking to him the other day. He called me and he asked me if I'd heard that new Metallica song on the radio. And I was like, oh, Lux Eterna? And he was like, oh, no, this was some other thing. And I think what he referenced was from Justice. And I was like, that song's older than my
there
sister.
There are two singles out now.
Yeah, and it wasn't either of them.
Oh, okay, okay.
But that's because he is a perfect example. My dad is like, he likes rock, heavy rock, not super into the metal world, but definitely rock and then further into prog rock. But he loves the Black Album. He considers that absolutely 100% top tier for them. But I don't. He's never listened to Kill 'Em All. I don't know if he could spot in the wild anything from Justice or from Lightning and Justice or Puppets. Like, you know, Puppets probably, but pre-Black is not his world at all.
Mm-hmm.
He's a perfect example of who you're talking about.
It's just crazy to me the separation between those two groups of people, I guess.
Oh yeah, I mean,
it's so crazy when you think about, like, there's so much more in common between that and then, like, 100% of the other music out in the world, you know. And that this is the kind of thing that you and I have we have had this conversation thousands of times
for the last 15 years.
Yes, and I show you something that I think you're gonna like and you don't like it because it's just not heavy enough, and it's just like, and I'm to me, the heaviness is, like, relative, but, like, the heavy stuff that's fast is exciting and fun because it's heavy and fast, but it's no less metal than something that's slow with, like, orchestra and clean vocals and stuff over it, because to me, metal isn't just something that's fast and heavy. But I know that's just getting into terminology.
I'm making a silly.
And
I,
heavy
I
doesn't.
I know that. I know that, and I'm not trying to, like, crap on you, but, like, we've done this so many times, so many times, and, like, you even said in one of the videos, you're like, I wish that I could learn to like this kind of thing. We were talking about electronics and music, because Chris, did you see where I showed him I See Stars?
Oh, I haven't seen that.
You should watch just. You should watch just the clip when the guy starts singing. I showed him Filth Friends Unite. Do you remember that song? Is that from
the
Digital Renegades? Digital Renegades.
Yeah, that one. I'm not as familiar with that one.
Right. It's
New Demons and Treehouse.
It's one of the dubstep ones, and it starts and it's so heavy and stuff, and then it goes right into the chorus when he's doing the Coheed for Cambria style vocals.
Yeah, Devin Oliver vocals. Yeah.
Yeah, whatever. But, like, in the video. Chris's reaction is so freaking funny. It's exactly what I knew was going to be, and I did, like, a zoom on it and stuff. He couldn't, if he'd have rolled his eyes any farther, he'd have been looking out his ass. Like, it was so awesome. So everyone that's watching this, if you haven't seen, it's our, when we reacted to Kim Dracula, Korn, and I See Stars video.
Oh,
it was, like, a fun little thing.
Video.
But then we talked about electronics and music, and you've said that over the years I've tried to show you things and that you wanted to like it, but there was just something in it. Or something missing from it that you didn't get, that you didn't like, that was a vibe thing.
Well, that goes both ways. Someday I will figure out what that is. But that goes both ways because, like, I have tried to explain to you, like, how much that you should like something like Ride the Lightning.
Right.
Though not that exact example. And and you're just like, nope, this is stupid. Like, it doesn't come back to the chorus and it doesn't really sound that good.
Right,
and, like,
right. And so it's just funny. But I'm just saying, like, we've had this conversation a million times. Chris, how did you feel about listening to this album?
I don't remember the last time I sat and really listened to this album like this. And I almost feel like
you've listened to this more recently, but you've really expanded your audio horizons a lot in the last like 5 to 7 years.
Yeah,
so do you feel like you understand? Right? Do you feel like you understand? Yo, sure. Do you feel like you understand a lot of this stuff that we're talking about better now?
Oh, sure.
I mean, not that you wouldn't have before, but you know what I mean. Like,
yeah, yeah.
I feel like you're much more equipped to talk about stuff like this now than you were when we were doing Music Room.
Mm-hmm. I believe that.
So
and it's interesting because, like, for me and metal, once you get into the hyper speed with no clean vocals at all, just like the pig noises, like that's. You've gone into the world where I don't want to be anymore. It's like I would get, you know, pull out from that just a little bit. Periphery is probably the heaviest I'll go and still enjoy myself.
Do you like Periphery?
I don't know.
I mean, they're more of like a genty thing. To me, I would not think that you would like
what's
them.
What's the Canadian band with the really good singer, the Pomplamoose guys?
Oh, is Protest the Hero?
Yeah.
I love Protest.
That's one of Chris's favorite bands.
I freaked out for like 2 weeks and like I just like on repeat because he did a cover with the 2 Minutes of Late Night Guys. But anyway,
I love Protest the Hero so much. They're one of my favorites, but there's so much about that type of music where it's like the vocals, if you're singing at some point, I'll be a fan of it.
Yep.
But if it just gets crazy and it's just that weird pig sound, that's just not my style. But I know plenty of people love it. And I won't say that there's anything wrong with it, but it's just like I'm not hard in that direction either. And I do like to go back to your question about this album. I don't want to say this, listening to it this time made me like it less than I otherwise have.
Mm.
But I don't know if I have a better way of saying it. I just kept wanting. It was like, I know this is heavier, right? Somewhere it's heavier than this, right? No. And it just, I don't know, it's really fantastic. It is really a fantastic album, but there's a reason I like Justice better. And that's, I don't know, they're just, I think this, it has a certain like hyper glossy kind of, man, sellout is a term I hate. Hate using that term. I hate the idea that anybody who, you know, it doesn't make any sense that a band, it's like, it's just built on this gatekeepery kind of like, I love this band and I want them to do well, but I never want anyone else to hear them because then everybody will like them and then they'll get more money and then they'll sound like sellouts. And it's like, it just is a really nasty kind of attitude that keeps people from liking things for no reason. And I wouldn't be, I feel like the term sellout was invented for this album. And I'm not saying that as if it was like a negative thing, but I don't know. It just, it feels, it's got that high level of production. And like my best friend, this is her favorite Metallica album. And we've talked about this 1,000 times and I'm not deriding the Black Album. I will not do that, but.
Can I ask you a question?
Yes.
I wouldn't necessarily ask this to Chris because I know we would not go anywhere, but I know you well enough, Chris Parker, that I can ask you this. But something you said there was interesting. So I'm going to ask you, and you can take as much time as you want to think about it, okay? What makes a song heavy?
Oh, this is interesting because this is something I was thinking when you guys were talking about what makes a song heavy. Because
you just said,
I don't think you don't need speed to make a song heavy.
Mm-hmm. That's what I
think. I think in anything, like, if you could just have, you know, I mean, you need a lot of that low beef distortion in there, but it's like if you can just have every instrument doing the same thing at the same time,
and
you just
have
this big wall of just heavy, like, bleh, like that's really heavy stuff.
Right.
And it doesn't have to be fast at all.
And that's why a lot of people perceive like breakdowns in a song to be the heaviest part of the song.
Yes, exactly.
Right. That's the fun premise of that.
Oh yeah, for sure.
Low frequency, slower a little bit.
Yeah,
not that
drop
slow.
Drop it and just.
So you said while we were listening to this, you kept thinking, oh, it gets heavier than this.
Mm-hmm.
So what element could have been in this to make it heavier to you? Other than the speed of their first three albums.
Don't ask me that. Because my answer is just going to be speed.
I know. Well, that's the thing. That's kind of what you were implying. And so that's why I was just curious because...
Yeah, it's really a difficult path to walk.
If you ask me what would make this album better, I would say a few faster songs.
Like, think you about...
But
yes.
Really, there were only two, like...
God, that shocks me that you would say that. It's just so...
Well, but to me, that it adds to the variety. If I heard a well-produced, fast Metallica song, I would love to hear that. We haven't on the first three albums because none of them
have
been well-produced.
Eventually.
So it's like I don't... Here's... Variety is so important, I think. And so many of the bands that I like, you like literally never know what the next track is going to sound like. It could be anything. There could be rap on it. You know what I mean? And so, and Chris,
That's one thing that separates us is I don't go that far into the funhouse.
Right. But
you
know what I mean?
Like I still enjoy some structure in my life, but I think here's two great examples to go back to Protest the Hero. One thing that they do that I love as much as I hate is that you will get one of those really, really sweet, like heavy, like, and then it's done. And you get a second and a half of the best part of the song. And it's like, it's so good. And it's like, no, I just want more though. And so like, think about Creeping Death, for example. The breakdown in Creeping Death is the heaviest damn thing that ever was. And like, they slow down to just, you know, the big drop and then that. And it goes for so long. And it just like, I think even just, like the breakdown in, I think it was, and I'm using breakdown in quotes because I don't know what the hell to call it, but I think it was Don't Tread on Me at the end when I was like, this part here, this
the heaviest part
of
the
solo, the heaviest part of the song. Like, give me that for another, at least, like, I don't know, I'll just do it again. Just do it again, add a little bit of variety, make it even heavier, just stretch it out a little bit. Like, that would do a lot, I think.
Mm-hmm.
But it's tough. Because but I would also agree, just a like one or two faster songs. Give me just, you know, bridge the gap between Justice and Black just a little bit more.
Because I do think that for people who wanted this album, bought this album because they heard Enter Sandman and they wanted just pop stuff, those faster songs on there had to have been like, just as shocking to them as
I would agree
as the other way around. You know what I mean? People who were expecting it to be super fast and they got all this like these like slower pop songs.
I think on a terminology thing, which I think was a little bit of the genesis of what you just asked, Chris Parker.
Probably.
I think that maybe some of the time I say heavier.
Oh, I know.
And what I mean is more extreme.
Yeah, I don't want it to
because
seem like I was
attacking. Like in the whole scope of everything, like riffs do not get a whole lot heavier than Sad But True. Like that's a more dictionary definition of that anyway. Yeah,
but no, extreme is a good way to put it too.
And I mean,
does mean something different to me than heavy.
Right, and I sometimes I say heavy and now I realize that what I meant to say was extreme. But right, and I guess that's kind of what I was trying to say before, is that like I think that Metallica should get some credit for they should get a lot of credit because they however it happened, whether they wanted to or somebody else wanted them to make a record that was going to sell 32 million copies, that they did it and they still kind of did it like Metallica. Like, right? Like there's the almost instrumental song where that, like, I mean, maybe they were laughing about that when it happened. It's like everybody that's listened to the first three albums knows that this is going to be an instrumental song. We just put some lyrics over it.
Right.
It was a little bit lamer than the instrumental songs on the last three records. But, like, right, that there are some faster songs on there and that, yeah, I mean, it's
do you,
still
do you
Metallica.
Think some,
there's
do
lots
you,
of guitar solos. There's no guitar parts, which I really missed.
That is true.
Like, the middle section of Master Puppets is one of my favorite Metallica, might be my favorite Metallica moment, or the intro to Battery.
Right.
And it might be just those two things that make me think I like Master
That's
Puppets
interesting,
better
yeah.
than Justice. But, like, right, there aren't solos. They're just pretty parts, like, with harmony guitars, whether they're...
Yeah, like, one of the reactors that I've watched, they always go back to, like, the way that Metallica is so good at making perfect transitions between two parts of a song that have nothing to do with each other.
Yes.
And that is definitely absent here. It's just, you've got your type, and then that song just goes until it's over.
Yeah.
Consistency within a song. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
There's a couple like little hints to that, but yeah, not like those two that I was talking about. Like,
mm-hmm. Let me ask you this, okay? Do you think something can sound extreme if it has really good production?
Yeah.
Okay.
I can show you.
I have a very similar question for you, Patrick.
But we all know that like good production is relative to the genre that it's in too. You know, like,
oh, I can show you things that like legitimately sound good. You will hate them because you won't like the music.
But they sound good.
But they sound really, really good. That Goat Horror record, like that is one of them. Like it sounds really, really good.
What a great sentence.
I'm curious.
That Goat Horror record
sounds really, really good.
It does. I love it. It's fantastic.
What were you gonna say, Chris?
Do you think that rap can be heavy?
Absolutely.
I would absolutely say so, but it would be coming from a completely different place than...
I don't know. I mean, that there's stuff that you can do in rap music that's like... And even... Like, that is like Sad But True, if we're going to say that, because that is like some benchmark of heavy. But
and also, like, it's a rap song.
But like, also, I mean, there's like... I mean, whatever. I really know two rap records really well.
Right.
And like, if you go back to some of the early 90s from the same time as this, like stuff that Dr. Dre
NWA
was producing
and stuff. Yeah.
Right. Or like even the Doggy Style, like mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. There is stuff on there where like, it's not heavy, like heavy metal is, but like there is like a, you know,
yeah,
heaviness thing. It's not like, you know, it's not disco music.
Yeah.
But you want
to... There's an intensity to it.
Yeah. Yeah. And
but yeah, the intensity comes from different places in the different genres mm-hmm. of music too. Because rock music can get very... Rock music can get so intense and heavy that it borders into metal. But to me, the differentiation between a rock band and a metal band is overall output.
What does that mean, overall?
Overall output would be like Metallica is still a metal band, even though that they released the Unforgiven and Nothing Else Matters. But if a band made an album of 12 Nothing Else Matters and Unforgivens and one Master of Puppets, they're not a metal band. They're a rock band.
Yes, correct. True.
Right. So I'm just saying, like, you can be intense and heavy in the rock genre, and have Korn can have moments that are heavier than the average Metallica song. Even though I wouldn't think of Korn and Metallica in the same relative genre.
I
wouldn't say, oh, you like Korn, maybe you'll like Metallica, or vice versa. Like, I probably wouldn't recommend one of them to anybody who likes the other one.
And I'm sure that that's like that in like every right. of the big genres of music. Like,
but
right.
if you asked me which band was heavier, Korn or Metallica, I would have no problem saying Korn.
I think
is
I would
way
agree
heavier
you.
Than Metallica.
I would just not have an answer to that question. Like the it's like,
but that's what we've been talking about. Like it comes from a different place.
It's like, which one is more fish, a truck or a house? Like I just like that.
I missed what he said.
He said it didn't make any sense. Okay. He said, which one is more fish, a truck or a house? Right, but. But heaviness, that's what's so interesting about it, because when you use the same adjective to describe different genres of music, there has to be a connecting through line, or the word has no meaning.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? So like, when something is heavy, it has to be heavy in the same way that other things that also sound heavy are heavy. But the idea that a metal song can sound heavy and a rap song can sound heavy is so interesting to me.
Oh, you know what I mean? Back to, I mean, I think that one of the things, and like, there are, but you use the word heavy in so many different ways, because
I know,
you can
I
literally
know.
Mean it to like how much something,
but emotional
how much mass
impact,
something has.
But also emotional impact.
Emotional yeah. impact. Also, like, when things just have like too much lows or low mids, and you're just like, and even right,
bass
if
heavy.
it's a like acoustic song about picking flowers, right? Like, you can be like, boy, this just like, this mix yeah. is really heavy, or that guitar is too heavy, not like
right.
in a dun, 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 kind of way, but like,
yeah.
But like, I think that like, if you're talking about musically heavy, because there are also a lot of records that sound terrible. I'm not going to name any names to save myself. But like, right, I think that one of the things is, and Chris said this earlier, but like, I think that speed is the enemy of heavy, if we're talking about it like in the musical sense. Not in the audio sense, in the musical sense, and like, and using it not to mean extreme or intense, right? Like, speed is the opposite. Like, if you're gonna say which song is heavier, Sad But True or Master of Puppets, Sad But True, like, because it's slower.
Right.
And it makes you want to do this instead of...
Right. That's... Yeah. I don't know. I don't think we solved any world issues there.
No, we're, no, we're, and the whole argument is so dumb. I just love to
I was going to say, I don't think it's dumb at all. I love this kind of thing. But you always say genre is a myth, and I just couldn't disagree with that anymore. I think the genrefication of music is so fun to talk about.
It's super fun to talk about. Yeah. It's basically
the new Periphery album is called Gent is Not a Genre.
Yeah, I saw that.
It's just great.
Yeah, it
but
is great.
It's interesting because this actually bridges over into a lot of the stuff that I deal with as a sound designer when people want things to sound a certain way, but they have absolutely no idea how to describe
how to articulate
and you have to dig it out.
Mm, yeah, that's tough.
And that's really tough.
Yeah.
Is Periphery's Misha Mansour, right? No, that's...
Is that a person or a song?
That's
or?
A person.
Oh, I don't know those people.
I don't know
Periphery. Are they the ones? Though. Are they the ones that did the Haunted Shores record? I don't think so. Yeah, it is. I'm gonna go look it up now.
Yes,
because then now I will. I'm developing my opinion about Periphery, and it is basically that. Because if this is correct,
don't they have that sort of whiny singing I don't like, Chris?
Yes. Yeah. A little, but it's not. It is definitely not the worst.
But Periphery is more Meshuggah than Metallica, right?
Yeah, oh, Periphery is definitely proggier, I think.
But
like,
they're groove metal.
Yeah, you should listen to Reptile. That song is so good. It's 16 minutes. It changes all over the place, and it rules, man.
That's cool.
Good.
Yeah. So for sure. Haunted Shores is Mark Holcomb and Misha Mansour.
Is that a band? A secondary?
Haunted Shores is Periphery without vocals.
Oh.
And it is...
I would hate it.
It is very, very, very good. And I really, really like it. And I listened to that. I heard that there was some noise about it when that came out. And I listened to it. I'm like, this is really good. I'm going to try Periphery. And like, whatever.
He started singing,
and like I just couldn't. Yeah, I agree with that. Couldn't. But
the
music is super cool,
fantastic.
And that thing is really good. You should go listen to that if you haven't already.
I'm good. I've got it pulled up right now.
It's awesome.
Shores. Okay, well, I would say that based on how long our first recording was, we're over 3.5 hours, so we can end this. But I think that everything we've had great conversation. I think.
Uh huh.
And I wanted to say this at the beginning, but I'll say it now because there's not a human being left on the planet that's ever going to watch this far into the video. But don't do that.
We could swear now.
I got to bring my track down too when you do that, and it sounds weird because I there's going to be total silence now when you do that. But what I was going to say was, I wanted to say this at the beginning, but there was the initial plan when we started doing these Metallica reactions on my channel was to have Chris Parker here with us. So that we could do 72 seasons for sure, if not have him here with us for all of them. And it just is so much easier because Chris is here with me. It's just so much easier for us to do this. And we were not planning to do like extra things like the Black Album or Kill 'Em All or whatever. So like, because there might be people who, I don't know what the hell people are going to comment, but there might be people who are like, why did you get an extra person? I liked it just the two of them talking.
No, everybody's
going to
like Chris
Parker. You'll never please everyone,
Parker.
So it's not worth
trying. Everybody's going to like Chris Parker way more than they like me and Patrick.
Probably.
That's
because
I love
Chris talked about what the songs were about.
And also,
I did my absolute best.
That's true.
I sat here and I typed, what is this song about, into an AI 20 minutes before we started.
And, you know, it's funny, too, because we didn't see you at all the entire video. Like you're just the stupidest look on your face for 45 minutes.
I really honestly I'm going to embrace it. I'm just thrilled to be sitting here like for
no,
the
it wasn't
whole time.
That bad. Well, I'll probably find like stupid GIFs or something and put them over you so that it's like I don't know, just Godsmack GIFs the whole time.
Yes,
Godsmack
please.
And corn GIFs.
God,
we're gonna end it now because we've been talking for 150,000 hours, which is interesting because that's how many
almost a full day's work on my end. I think I started doing this at like 3:30.
Oh, that's true for you. It's okay. All right. Well, we're just gonna say goodbye. I don't know if we'll record anything else. I was gonna ask Chris Parker if maybe he wanted to do Kill 'Em All with me at some point.
I could be a part of that, yeah.
Maybe want to try to do that at some point.
I hope it isn't 6 hours worth. But
well, if it's well, we had fun. So
yeah.
let's not literally make this 6 hours and just end it here. Thank you very much for watching. We had a lot of fun, and hopefully you'll come back and not be scared away from this. I promise to God, our 72 seasons reaction will not be this long.
Yes, it will.
Yeah, it totally will.
It probably will. But
thank you.
Yep. Bye, everybody.
Bye. I can't tell if Chris is there or not. Okay, there you are. I couldn't hear you, and you still have not moved in like 20 minutes. It's quite
That's
funny.
Still look very thoughtful.
That's amazing. At least the pose isn't stupid.
No, but the one that Patrick will text you later is ridiculous.
Mm-hmm. Okay, let's. Can you clap one more time for me? 3, 2, 1. Be really great if I could get that clap on video. Just clap a few times. You haven't moved yet since the look on your face is pretty stupid, to be honest. it's not a flattering look on your
face. It's actually pretty good.
Don't do it.
I'll send this to Patrick.
I've had an idea for like a Twitter account for quite a while that's just anytime I'm watching something and I pause it and they have a ridiculous pause face, I just take that screenshot and I post it with no context.
Yep, that's a good idea.
That would be
a great idea.
Okay, where are we at now?